Okay, we're going to call this work session to order. The first item of business is a proclamation for World AIDS Day, and I would like to invite the Reverend Pastor Rob Apgar Taylor and the Administrative Assistant of Veritas United Church of Christ, Michael Jones, to accept this proclamation. Please come on up.
How are you doing? Doing well.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks.
This is a proclamation for World AIDS Day. This is December 1st, 2015, whereas World AIDS Day is held on December 1st each year and is an opportunity for people worldwide to unite in the fight against HIV, show their support for the people living with HIV, and to commemorate people who have died. And whereas the global epidemic of HIV infection and AIDS requires a worldwide effort to increase communication, education, and united action to stop the spread of HIV/AIDS, and whereas globally an estimated 34 million people have HIV, more than 35 million people have died from the virus, making it one of the most destructive pandemics in history, and whereas World AIDS Day serves as a reminder for citizens to educate themselves about the risk of HIV, know their HIV status through testing, receive care if infected, and demonstrating compassion for those infected and affected by HIV and AIDS. Now, therefore, be it resolved with the support of the City Council, I, David Geisberts, the Mayor of the City of Hagerstown, do hereby affirm its commitment to the public health and proclaim December 1st, 2015, as World AIDS Day in Hagerstown. Gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm still shaking with the left. I have this bump finger. Would you like to say a few words?
Just thank you very much, Mr. Mayor, City Council as well. I pastor a church in Frederick as well as Veritas here in Hagerstown, and I don't know a lot of other cities that are doing this today in our area. Maybe there are, and it's just quiet. I don't know. I've lived in Hagerstown for 14 years. I am very proud that you have chosen to do this. I just want to say thank you because it shows where we've come from, where we are, and I'm really proud that you serve me. Thank you so very much. Mike wants to share just a couple of thoughts real quick on where we are in Western Maryland.
Thank you.
I would like to reiterate Pastor Rob's thanks for the council and the mayor doing the proclamation. In the media today, we don't hear a whole lot about HIV/AIDS, but yet it's still just as prominent as ever, if not more so. And in order to make this a little bit more closer to home for everybody, I'd like to share some of the Western Maryland statistics off of the DHMH website. Frederick, Washington, Allegheny, and Garrett counties at the end of 2013 had 678 cases of people living with HIV and 29 new cases reported that year. Washington County accounted for 296 of those cases of people living with HIV and AIDS. 17.7% of that population aged 30 to 39, 30.4% of that population was 40 to 49 years of age, and 30% ages 50 to 59, to give you an idea of the age brackets most affected. 67.4% of the people living with HIV/AIDS were male and 32.6% female. 33% were heterosexual and 49% MSM. That's the snapshot of people living with HIV and AIDS in Washington County, Western Maryland.
Well, thank you both for being here to accept this proclamation. Well, that's okay. I'll take my risk on this handshake. But I want to thank you also for helping us educate the public about this ongoing problem. And I think Aaron wants to get a picture here.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
We have another proclamation recognizing our finance department. Team, come on up. Thank you.
I apologize for the service.
No worries. We don't take it personally.
You're not going to go to the
cash
cage thing?
No, I can't.
This is a certificate of appreciation presented to the employees of the City of Hagerstown Finance Department. The Mayor and City Council would like to recognize the employees of the City of Hagerstown's Finance Department for being receiving the Distinguished Budget Presentation Award for the current budget from the Government Finance Officers Association, the GFOA. This is the highest form of recognition in governmental budgeting and represents a significant achievement by the city of Hagerstown. It reflects the commitment of the governing body and staff to meeting the highest principles of governmental budgeting. In order to receive this budget award, the city of Hagerstown had to satisfy nationally recognized guidelines for effective budgeting presentation. These guidelines are designed to assess how an entity's budget serves as, number one, a policy document, number two, a financial plan, number three, an operations guide, and number four, a communications device. Budget documents must be rated proficient in all four categories and the 14 mandatory criteria within those categories to receive this award. The Government Finance Officers Association is a major professional association servicing the needs of more than 18,000 appointed and elected local, state, and principal, provincial level government officials and finance practitioners. It provides top quality publications, training programs, services, and products designed to enhance the skills and performance of those responsible for government finance policy and management. And the GFOA's Distinguished Budget Presentation Awards Program is the only national awards program in governmental budgeting. So, on behalf of everybody around this table, it's our honor, and we thank you, each and every member of the city's finance department. We congratulate you on a job well done. Madam Director, would you like to say a few words?
I would just like to say that, as we all know, the budget document is not, you know, just one group, one member, one part of the city. It's all members of the city. It's the leadership at the table. So we thank you all and your efforts and your help and your assistance. And I say this especially now because the department managers are all in the midst of starting fiscal year 17. Actually, this document and this award is not possible without my entire group. We spend many, many hours. March Madness gives whole new meaning in my department because we're here sometimes 7 days a week the whole month.
Do you want to introduce the staff that are here and give a shout out to those who are?
Sure. So we'll start with in the back, Raina Rose, our county manager. She does help assist throughout the budget document as well as the CAFR. And then our primary budget officer, Christine Sneeringer. The rest of our accounting department, I won't say by name, but each and every member helps in getting this document done. It's 400 plus pages every single year. So thank you all.
Great. Thank you. Give them a round of applause.
Don.
Sure.
Do you want to do this case thing? I mean, I'll go, but I'd rather give you the opportunity. And Benny, do you want to go to case? I didn't recognize it. I thought it was a water plant. He just said, I know.
Okay, back to business. You ready? Mr. Brubaker?
No.
We're good?
No, you're
stuck. Next is the 2016-2017 Pavement Preservation Program.
Good afternoon. As we're wrapping up our paving for this year, we still have a couple streets left to do, and of course the state's working on Route 40. It's not too early for us to start talking about our plans for 2016 and 2017. I think it's good that we put together a plan like this that has a couple years outlook. I just met with Columbia Gas this afternoon about this whole issue, and they said there's many municipalities they work in where they get weeks notice, maybe a few months, but we give them 2 to 3 years notice. So it's a dynamic process. The list keeps changing, working with them and other utilities, but it's a good process for us to go through. So we have a recommendation on a list of streets in the packet that we would like for you to review and hopefully approve this month so that we can say this is our official list. The way we put that list together is we did a pavement condition survey. We did the last one back in 2012 where we looked at all 115 miles of streets. We go and we physically have them, we drive them with a vehicle that takes pictures, does profile of the road, very complex way of gathering the data that we can look at the roads and rate them as to what maintenance they need. We did that again this past year, and what the results show was that we've lost a little bit of ground in 3 years. There's several reasons for that. One reason is because our highway user revenue has not been up to what we need, and this is just another cry for that, and we've said that many, many times to state officials whenever we get the opportunity, but that's hurt us slightly here. Some of the other issues that we had, that we have some ongoing patchwork that Columbia Gas is doing in various places. Some of our own paving isn't done, so that didn't show up in the survey. But nevertheless, we lost a little bit of ground, but mostly because of the funding lapse due to the highway user revenue. We take these lists then and we share them with all the utilities, specifically Columbia Gas, who, as everybody knows, does these major main replacements. They, as I said, we met with them today. They've seen these lists. They have a lot of work to do. They have a lot of bare steel pipe that they are trying to eliminate in our community that results in a lot of leakage and therefore cutting up the streets. So they, we coordinated that with them. Several of the streets on the 2016 list, they'll be making main replacements in prior to us paving. Other places, they'll be making main replacements, and they're going to be milling and paving based on our new policy that we passed a few months ago. And that's, I think that's showing benefits already. As far as the budget goes, we have a little bit of money that we're carrying over, but by and large, it's going to rise and fall with what we can fund with our highway user revenue. So it pays for our payment management program. And it's essential that we continue to press for that. Of course, the curb and sidewalk notices will go out for the 2017 streets. Those will go out early next year. And the last thing I wanted to say about all this, then I'll open for questions, is the alley condition. We did an alley condition survey as well, which is the first time the city's ever done that. It's not surprising that the alleys, or the condition survey there showed it was a rating that was much lower than our streets. Our alleys need some work. So you have put in the CIP for next year a large project to replace quite a list of alleys, and that's what this one map shows, is all the alleys that we're proposing to replace in the next year, which is a nice chunk. When you look at that second map, though, it shows where all the alleys are in the city. It's a little overwhelming how many alleys are in the city, but they need to be maintained, and highway user revenue, again, would be the source of funds there. And what our survey and our software indicate to us is that we should be spending about $250,000 a year just to maintain. So we want to try to do even better on the alleys. But I think this will be a nice jump start what we're planning to do this year. We'll be back in later with contracts to replace all these alleys. So, but what we're asking for later this month at the voting session is that you approve the 2016-2017 lists that are in the packet. Any questions?
Well, I'm going to thank you and the engineering staff for your really good work on this. I think the pavement preservation program is a tremendously valuable program for obvious reasons, that
it's
people want
service.
Their street paved. Right.
Yeah.
We want good streets. And
right.
The fact that we are able to use highway user revenue to pretty much cover that expense has been very helpful, and you're absolutely correct that it remains a priority for this mayor and council at the state level that we get that full restoration of highway user revenue. And I know Councilmember Brubaker has led that charge with folks at the state level and MML for years. So I just want to thank you for that. And I think you've obviously put a lot of work and effort into narrowing these lists down, and see if the council has any questions or feedback. Go ahead, Mr. Brubaker.
Yeah, so I'll just pick up where the mayor left off, and thank you for these lists, for looking ahead. And, you know, it's been, I think, a compliment to all the councils I've served on that there has been relatively little political log rolling or unfair complaints. They know how hard you work at this list. And during that time, you've improved the way we look at it by, you know, actually using measurement techniques and so forth, which, by the way, I'd used just last week at the MML chapter meeting with the delegation about how we really know what we're doing. We need the HERs to actually do it.
That's right.
So if I told them we have
a plan. We just need to implement.
Mayor Hancock says, well, we don't have a machine that looks at our roads.
Yeah.
But anyhow, but I wanted to expand on that a little bit. And just this list is an example. On the 2016,
And I'm not asking to take it off. I'll just make the comment that, you know, as is bound to happen, one of the streets is really a, when it's outside the city, a state highway, Frederick Street's alternate 40. Mm-hmm. And that's about, really about 30% of the total square yards for 16. Mm-hmm. And in 17, we have Salem Avenue, which is Route 58, also a state highway maintained up to the city limits, but not in, so that's a lower percentage, but still a significant chunk is state highways that end at the city line. So that's been a subject, as some of you know, a concern of mine for a long time. And I've talked to Rodney about it over the years, and we've thrown some numbers around. And because we fought so hard for HURs, and we haven't wanted to distract from that, I haven't brought it up specifically, just generally at times when I'm testifying. I would like, to have Rodney look at it this time and give us some specific numbers. I count 9 state highways coming into the city at 11 locations. 9 state highways. The state maintains one of those. Coming in at, depending on how you count it, 13 different locations where the entry points into the city. And I think a significant amount of money could be saved if the state met their responsibility. Our taxpayers, again, are double taxed. We pay a gas tax when we go to the gas station. We're triple taxed. We pay for county highways, we pay for state highways. But here, this is nothing to do with the county. It's nothing to do with the regional state office of the Highway Administration. They don't have authority to move ahead. This will have to come from the top. But I want it as an argument for HURs, and if HURs don't move to satisfaction, I think we should move forward on our own with after looking at it again and looking at the results. So I would like the staff by January, and I've talked to Rodney and Valerie, and they think this can be done, because again, we've looked at it. We've talked about what some of the numbers might be. And it's hundreds of thousands of dollars at least, not even counting capital.
So you want the number of roads that are state highways? The cost. You want numbers in terms of cost.
Well, I want costs. I want him to confirm the lane mileage or whatever.
Square yardage,
whatever number you think is appropriate, mm-hmm. and not too hard to do. And I don't mean that this has to be done to the last detail, like it was something being put out to bid.
Are you talking about just paving, or are you talking about snow plowing and everything?
No, I'm talking about paving, plowing, operating costs, and the whole bit. But separate it out so that we know. Mm-hmm. Now, the downsides are that it could affect the distribution of city employees. But the bigger downside is that we could conceivably lose some control over those streets. But, you know, that would have to be measured against probably several cents off the tax rate, mm-hmm. if we could ever bring it about. So if nobody has an objection, I would like to have that. And if I could have it by January or mid-January, it'd be good to take down.
Any objections? Thank you for that suggestion. Any other questions or feedback on the lists?
Just Mr. Robinson. Rodney.
Yes, sir.
It's not on this list, but there's been a great deal of work done on the lower half of Hamilton Boulevard.
Mm-hmm.
I assume in preparation for paving.
Yes.
Pretty soon. Mm-hmm. Do you know when?
Hopefully next week.
Hopefully next week. Okay.
Those people have been.
Yeah, they've.
If the weather cooperates.
Been very patient.
And it doesn't snow.
There's 2 streets that are left to pave. We still have a piece of South Burhan's. Between basically Basil Boulevard and the second bridge down, there's a stretch there that's on this year's contract, and then the section you're talking about. Hopefully the weather holds out and we'll get those done next week.
And do you want to talk about the liquidated damages?
Yeah, the contracts are written that there's a damage clause in there if the contractor doesn't deliver all the work by a certain time. On the paving contract, we try to get the work done. We tell them in the contract by early October.
Mm-hmm.
It's studies have shown that if you can pave when the weather is warmer, the pavement lasts longer, you get a better job.
Yeah.
It's just kind of common sense. And obviously our contractor this year is way behind, as are most of the paving contractors. It seems like in the industry right now, there's an inflow of money, especially from state highway, and the contractors are overwhelmed with work.
There's not enough of them.
And they don't even know, there's not enough of them anymore because of the recession. We lost a couple, and they're all behind. So they're in a liquidated damage situation, so we'll be working with them to pay that fine.
Okay. Any other questions or feedback?
Well, and they're all behind everywhere. And that's the key. It isn't like we could go to Frederick, Allegheny.
Right.
Get one of those.
They're all sitting around doing nothing. Exactly.
I do have a question on that. Given what you said, Rodney, and it's now the first week of December, and I commiserate with everybody in the situation of waiting and waiting and waiting. But are we going to get a road that's going to be good for it and the type of weather conditions that you would expect in December?
We'd only allow them to do the work if the temperatures are within the state highway specifications, which is, I think, 40 degrees and rising. So if it gets below that, we won't let them do it.
Oh, it's 40.
Mm-hmm. For surface mix, for the actual
top. That's good, because I heard 32. 40.
That's for the base.
I'm worried about that.
That's for base mix.
Okay.
Which we're talking about surface mix. So if the weather doesn't cooperate, we won't do it.
Okay. It's 32 for base mix, 40 for the overlay.
Correct.
Your point being, Mr. Messner, that people would probably rather wait till a time where they'd have a good road that lasts than
We've all had some experiences with roads that get it all done, and within literally months, if not a year or two, people were going, "What? I thought we just fixed this road." So, and obviously, the county had a major problem some time ago. I don't mean to insult Rodney by asking the question, because he obviously isn't going to let them do it if it's not going to be right.
It's a good question,
Rod. I want to thank you too for coming up with a plan for alleys.
Yeah, it's overdue.
Alleys are really used in our community. Mm-hmm. People walk them all the time. Kids ride their bicycles in them all the time.
Yeah.
And
adults ride their bicycles in them too.
Well, I don't doubt that.
If you're from Hagerstown, you use the alleys.
That's right.
When they deteriorate so badly that they're practically incapable of being used, that's a bad thing. So thank you for you and your department coming up with a responsible plan.
And it adds value to the properties with alleys.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Any other questions or feedback on the pavement preservation program? All right, we'll move on to the bridge program then.
This is just an update. Sometimes these can be kind of forgotten, and I don't know that it's been a long time since I've just discuss with you how we manage our bridges. So basically, in the city and really across the nation, there's three categories of bridges. There's the clever names of the major bridges, the minor bridges, and also we'll talk about the storm drains. The major bridges are spans that are over 20 feet long, that from end to end. Minor bridges are from 6 feet to 20 feet. The major bridges, we have 12 of those, and most of those are in very good condition. They're inspected every 2 years, and because of the federal aid program, we can leverage federal funds to do the inspection work and have a professional structural engineer do those inspections every 2 years. We get nice bound reports, so we have a very great amount of detail about those 12 bridges. And that's all done in cooperation with Washington County Engineering. They do a fantastic job of helping me manage this, and they manage, Washington County's got hundreds of bridges. We have 12 that are inside the city. And so they're a great help to me. Some of the work that we're doing on the major bridges, you may remember about a year ago, we awarded a contract for $1.2 million to do rehab of 3 bridges on Burrhands Boulevard, and that work's underway. It'll be finished next summer, and that's to strengthen the bridges underneath. And that's moving along. We recently advertised a contract for replacing the expansion dams, which is at the end of the bridges. It's just kind of it's kind of a seal that goes in there where the road stops and the bridge begins. And unfortunately, we couldn't get any bids on that. It's something we're going to have to rethink on how we're going to get this done, because it's kind of a stitch in time saves nine kind of thing. If you maintain that and the water doesn't get down into the understructure, you know, the bridge will last longer. So.
Would you be able to talk to other municipalities that also?
Yeah, that's actually I was talking to the city engineer at Cumberland, who has a lot of bridges, and I think there's a potential there. I think that is how we're going to
might be the best way to go about
right,
it.
Right. So I might be coming in sometime with a piggyback contract on something like that. And then just last week, this is related to a bridge on South Prospect Street. There's a retaining wall on the east side in the northeast side of the bridge. A vehicle ran off the South Prospect, ran through the railing, and collapsed a 20-foot section of this wall. And as we examined the wall, it's about 150 feet long. It needs completely replaced. It needed that beforehand. Eric Dyke and I actually were up there 2 weeks ago before this accident and saw the condition of this wall, and it needs to be replaced. So,
is there any possibility of getting any damages from the insurance company?
Yes,
from this?
Yes, and they can pay for the portion that they destroyed. So it'll pay for, you know, maybe
something.
A quarter of it
right.
or something like that. But that is a CIP that we're going to be looking at here soon, because that wall basically supports South Prospect Street. So.
Sure.
It's something we're going to work on.
Tell me again, where's that wall?
If you're driving up South Prospect Street, the Presbyterian Church is on the left. Before you get to the bridge, there is an ornamental green railing that's on the left-hand side. The vehicle hit that railing and blew out the wall that it's anchored to, a section of it.
Is part of the wall underground?
You really, it's... The road is, you're riding up here, and the wall drops down like this
and
to
then
the adjacent lot.
Vacant
so
apartment
you really don't
building
see it
or something next
Street,
to that.
But
yeah.
it's supporting Prospect Street.
Okay.
That's the problem. So that'll be in our budget requests. On the minor bridges, these are, we have 17 structures in the city that are 6 to 20 feet long. They're inspected every 5 years, and the point I wanted to make here is that inspection's due next year. We can't use federal funds for those, so what we do is we work with the county again on this to get an economy of scale so that we can hire a consultant firm that will wind up inspecting, you know, maybe 300 or 400 of these across all of Washington County. And the ones in the city, we have funded that inspection in the past, and the list of those are on here. And as I said, there's 17 of those. They're all in pretty good shape. None of them are in our CIP for the upcoming years. But we want to continue to inspect those to make sure they are in good shape.
Can I just make one minor correction that I'm
yes.
sorry I didn't mention to you earlier, but HAG-16, I believe, is a tributary of the Antietam Creek, because that's your Hager Park crossover. And maybe it got confused with HAG-19.
Right. No, you're absolutely right.
Hager's Crossing.
Yeah.
But I just thought, for the record, maybe.
You're correct.
You might want to fix that.
Yeah, the only one because the Conkidget Creek is out on Hagers Crossing
right.
Drive. And then the last thing would be the storm drains. I mean, there's a whole, as I said in the memo, there's a labyrinth of storm drains under the city. Some of them are easily big enough that we could walk through comfortably.
I want to do that sometime. I told you that before, right?
Yeah.
That is on my bucket list.
Right.
Start down on Mulberry Street.
I would like to thank you before.
Yeah, one of them goes right through the Elizabeth Hager Center in the basement. You can actually
see
it.
Could do that for a work session.
In the storm drain.
Advertise it in public and everything.
My husband was 4 years old and started at Mulberry Street and ended up downtown.
Yeah. And I've been a lot of them myself. We haven't inspected them routinely. It's a confined space issue. It's a safety issue. We're using today's standards.
Get some helmets with lamps and everything.
That, but you'd have to, breathing apparatus.
Yeah. Oh, really?
they don't have any problem with it.
Right.
But to do it correctly, you need all that. But we last inspected it about 20 years ago, actually, some of the bigger drains. We corrected the issues that were then. It's probably due for that to happen again. So we'll be working that into the budget also. And but they're surprisingly good. Most of those structures are brick bottoms, stone, dry laid stone, and then a brick arch, and they're still looking very good, even though they're 100, 150 years old.
It'll make them like that anymore.
No. So that's kind of the program and how we try to keep these safe and usable for the public.
So what you just said, if I may, there's a lot of controversy about unsafe bridges in the United States.
Mm-hmm.
This issue pops up every once in a while. What you're saying is that every bridge in the city of Hagerstown is perfectly safe.
Yes, it's perfect.
No issues with any of them?
The only issues we have are cosmetic issues and just routine maintenance things that we have to keep after constantly, but they're perfectly safe, yes.
Go ahead, Mr. Rubio.
Just to further the earlier observation, 5 of the 12 major structures are on what would be state maintained roads. 4 of them are on federal aid, state gets specific money for the time. 3 of the minors are on what I calculate as would be state highways if they were in the county.
That's a good point. If a bridge was on Pennsylvania Avenue and it was outside the city, state highway would fix it. But just because it's inside the city, it becomes ours. The county doesn't fix it outside, but the state does.
Well, it's true of all those highways. Mm-hmm. The county has no responsibility. It's all state.
Right.
Plowing, maintaining, painting, the whole paving, everything. And it stops at 0. It hits the city line.
Right.
0.
Very good observation. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks for the good work on this report. Next, we have the FY15 Comprehensive Annual Financial Report. I'd like to invite our esteemed Director of Finance and the rest of her crew up. Let you introduce everybody else once you get here.
Hello again, everybody.
Greetings.
Hello, haven't we seen you before today?
I know, right? So this evening, even more exciting than budget, we are actually going to talk about our fiscal year 15 audit and fiscal year 15 year-end results. Our CAFR was distributed several weeks ago when we got it bound in hard copy. That CAFR and our audit would not be possible without the assistance of our auditing partners and SB and company. Many of you will remember William Bill Seymour. He's here tonight just to go over and explain the different procedures and things that were looked at during the audit.
Thank you very much. Good evening. This represents our required communications under generally accepted auditing standards. I have a presentation. I'm going to walk through that. Please feel free at any time to stop me with any questions that you may have. The scope of services, we are engaged to perform. We did perform an audit of the June 30, 2015 financial statements. Performance of the OMB Circular A133 audit, that's a federal grants compliance audit that's mandated by the federal government. Review of the Uniform Financial Report, that basically takes your financial statements and puts them in a fit and format that meets the Maryland Department of Legislative Services needs, as well as the review of the OMB Data Collection Form, which effectively takes your single audit and places that in the format of information for the federal government, and then working with management on a year-round basis. Summary of the results, we've issued an unmodified opinion on the financial statements. That's the best opinion that I'm allowed to issue under generally accepted auditing standards. What that basically says is that the financial statements as presented by management are reasonably free of material misstatement. We discovered no instances of fraud, nor were we made aware of any. We discovered no material weaknesses or significant deficiencies in internal controls. We received the full cooperation from management, and we had no audit adjustments that were posted as part of the audit. One major item that occurred this year was the city was required to adopt GASB 68. And what GASB 68 is accounting for pensions, and what that required is that the difference between the total pension liability and your market value of assets today, that difference has to be recorded on the financial statements. And as a result of that, we had to restate the opening balances by roughly $39 million, a decrease of that to record the opening liability. Otherwise, if we would record all of it in the current year, the statement of activities would have been materially incorrect for that.
Could you, just for the benefit, there's a lot of people watching, explain what GASB is?
Sure, GASB is the Government Accounting Standards Board. They are the authoritative body that sets the accounting principles that state and local governments must follow in their financial statements. On this slide, we have a pictorial of our audit approach. What this audit approach is really grounded on is assessing the risk of material misstatement, how management has designed and operated controls to mitigate that risk, performance of various analytical procedures, substantive procedures, and other generally accepted auditing standard procedures that allow us to arrive at that unmodified opinion. So we start by assessing the control environment, and we follow the COSO model of internal controls, the five interrelated components of the control, which is the control environment, risk assessment, the specific control activities, information and communication, and lastly, monitoring. And you can see in all cases, our assessment is that it's effective. Us as auditors, we don't use lots of positive items, but effective is kind of the auditor A, if you will, in doing your work.
It's the same in education, too.
Please take note, Raina and I got an A.
The next couple of slides, we also look at the evaluation of key processes and the underlying significant functions. And what we do is a variety of work, walkthroughs, tester controls of substantive procedures. Once again, what we would be saying here is that if there was a problem, we would have opportunities for improvement, a significant deficiency or material weakness. And what the idea there is that the telltale sign is that if we would have lots of journal entries through the audit, if there were errors that we discovered that weren't caught during the course of management's processes, then what we would be required and what we would report to you is to say, hey, the information that you've received during the course of the year, the system that's providing that information may have flaws. We didn't have any of those issues. So you can see here, in all cases, we were effective for those. GASB 68, as I mentioned earlier, required that the net pension liability be recorded. So we ended up recording an adjustment of $38.7 million as a reduction of net position, increase of liabilities. The balance as of the end of the year for both the city's plan as well as its participation in the Maryland State Retirement System collectively now is roughly just north of $40 million. To give you an idea, the net position of the city is $214 million, so it's a pretty significant portion of your net position. And then, not next year, but the following year, we will have similar accounting standards for OPEB that were just enacted for pensions. If that were enacted today, the net OPEB liability that would have been recorded roughly is about $25.5 million. I would like to stress that the accounting for pensions and OPEB does not impact the choices and how it's funded. What GASB wanted to do was get out of the funding business and more into staying into the accounting to say, here's what the difference is between the liability and the assets as of today. The only time that funding comes in involved in it is when how the determination of the spread of the city's participation in the state retirement system and the calculation of that liability. The results within the numbers, there's really, other than you can see the deferred inflows and deferred outflows, which predominantly are surrounding some timing difference in the recognition of pension expense. You're allowed to defer investment gains or losses over a five-year period. If there are actuarial gains or losses, you can defer that hit to the expense or the pickup to the expense over a certain period of time. The liability is what the liability is, it being that, and so we can smooth the effect of some things that are over the course of a period of time, and this is where it's shown on the statements. None of the other numbers we really had any issues or what we would have to bring to your attention. Here's a three-year summary of the activities, that being the changes in the net position, Once again, we had no real issues in any of these numbers. Management was prepared, had adequate support, allowed us to perform the auditing procedures that we needed to do, and we were able to complete those timely. The remainder of the presentation goes through our specific required communications. As I mentioned earlier, we've issued an unmodified opinion. There could be lots of ways that we could get there, lots of journal entries, you know, questionable accounting that's just barely acceptable, whether that's ultra conservative or ultra aggressive. We really didn't have any of those issues. Management was prepared, had adequate support for the information, the policies that the accounting selections that they've made are consistent and are reasonable, if you will, kind of middle of the road, not, you know, ultra conservative or ultra aggressive. We had, as I mentioned earlier, no fraud, no material weaknesses. We really didn't have any disagreements with management. We believe we have a very healthy relationship. It's a very open relationship. We talk throughout the year. As part of the audit, we did get a management representation letter. There was nothing special in that representation letter other than kind of the standard AICPA language that we're required to have. We can furnish you a copy if you would so choose to look at that. And lastly, we are independent. We go through a process on an annual basis to ensure that we're independent of the city, and I can certify to you that we are. I know I kind of went quick. I didn't know if there's any specific questions that I can answer for the committee. Yes, sir.
How much time does your company spend making this possible? I mean, how thorough? I guess what I'm really asking is pretty clearly, you're pretty thorough. That list of things that you started out with would indicate that. But can you comment on it?
Yeah, roughly the audit takes in somewhere in the neighborhood of 400 hours to complete. That's 400, and that goes across different levels within the firm. And we split that really into two what we would call major time segments. Mm-hmm. We do what we term preliminary procedures, where we're more focused on the processes, how cash is received, how cash is dispersed, payroll, fixed asset accounting. We do that, try and do that work really before year end. That way, if we were to identify an issue, we'd give management an opportunity to address it before we came out to do our final audit procedures. We perform the final audit procedures once management has closed the books and is predominantly done with the statements, that they can kind of turn it over and say, yep, we're comfortable with these numbers. That's always, there's kind of a chicken and the egg a little bit. They're always kind of working through, but giving us adequate time that we're able to perform the audit. They're able to meet all of the deadlines that's set by the state, as well as the GFOA's and their standard of excellence for the financials, that you issue your CAFR within 6 months mm-hmm. of year end, and the city is significantly ahead of that.
So it's pretty clear that they deserve the rate plus.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, I like the plus. Take notes.
Plus. Any other questions or feedback on the CAFR for our presenters? Mr. Burek.
I just want to comment that on the expenses, and this is the audited statement, not a budget, not a projection, not an estimate, but the audited statement, that every of the general expense categories that the auditors used, public safety and economic and community development, were the ones where there were major investments by the city and significant increase. The others were almost all straight line, very little change. Every other category was just about stable, straight line. But public safety was up $2.5 million, and economic and community development was up $2.7 million. So we are investing, and we're investing in the places I think the citizens would want us to invest. And I think this, the audit illustrates that.
And just to notate, Councilmember Brubaker's looking at slide number 15. This is our citywide governmental activity, so it's not specifically just a general fund. our capital improvement projects is in there, economic redevelopment fund. So when you see that line that says economic and community development, it is not necessarily just that department. The majority of all that increase is actually, yes.
And PAYGO.
Yes.
Sure. That our debt is even.
Yes.
Virtually even, our interest on debt.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Any other questions or feedback? Excellent presentation. Keep up the great work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is the FY17 healthcare program. Our Director of Human Resources is with us, and I'll let her introduce our other guests.
Now we come back down to earth.
I'll introduce her, that's okay. Thank you. I'm joined by Becky Royal.
Hi, Becky.
Becky is a senior employee benefits consultant with CBIZ Benefits and Insurances. And just as a little bit of background, CBIZ has been our benefits consultant since 2007. So in addition to this annual review in front of Mayor and Council, she also meets regularly with the Healthcare Committee and also works very extensively with Susan DeLauder, who's sitting right behind me. She's our benefits and wellness administrator and makes sure everything runs as it should and runs smoothly. So as I said, this is our annual information discussion. There's no formal action requested of this body this evening. It's an opportunity as we head into budget preparation and as well as negotiations to talk about the plan's performance, how we've done in the past, also look at some of the projections, as well as some alternative scenarios that we may consider as we move forward. Employee and retiree health care is a major component of an employee's total compensation package. It's also a major recruitment tool to attract and retain key employees. So as an employer, we want to make sure we have the best possible benefit we can offer while also being affordable. So with that, I'll turn it over to Becky and let her walk through the slides, and then we'll have time for questions as well.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I think you all have the packet in front of you. I need to use that. Okay. What we wanted to do is go through just kind of a look back at health plan costs here at the city, and then a projection looking at costs going into the next 5 years or so, and then talk about some possible ways to alleviate some of the projected cost increases. So on page 2, it's just a look at the employee contributions for the health plan going back to 2008. And these show the weekly amounts for the two medical plans that are in place here for active employees. And you can see that except for the employee-only tier of coverage in the level plan in 2010, there was an increase there. But all other contribution amounts have stayed the same going back to 2008, which means that all the increases that the plan has incurred have been absorbed solely by the city. Page 3 looks at total health plan costs. Your plan is self-funded, so that means that the city funds the claims as they're incurred and then pays some fixed costs for the vendors to administer the plan, as well as some insurance called stop loss for high cost catastrophic type claimants. And this exhibit on page 3 shows you the last 3 years of costs. This is active employees and retirees combined. And the total costs of the program have ranged from about $5.6 million to $6.3 million in the last 3 years. On page 4, we look at the cost for active employees only, and this is on a per employee basis. So the city's result is the darker green line, and you can see how that has increased each year. The national norm for government plans is the yellow line there, and you can see how the city's results were very close to that norm, except in the past year there was a spike. On average, if we look at the past 5 years, the active employees' health plan cost here has increased on average per year just under 10%, which is a little bit higher than the norm. Health plan costs nationally have been going up about 7 to 8%. So now that we've looked at historical costs, we also did a projection going into the 2020 plan year. And this assumes that no plan design changes are made and that no changes are made to employee or retiree contributions. And so this includes the active employee health plan, the retiree costs, and it also shows you the waiver credits. So right now, the city pays employees who choose not to enroll in the plan. They receive a $20 a week as a waiver credit. So you can see that's costs around $73,000 a year. So this shows you the total costs of those programs and then nets out the employee and retiree contributions, what they're paying towards the health plan cost. And you can see that last dark shaded line is the net cost to the city. So if you factor in health plan inflation and no plan changes and no changes to those contributions, you can see the net impact to the city each year. It's going up, you know, roughly 10% per year with the city continuing to absorb the entire increase. I think we've talked before about the 2018 Affordable Care Act excise tax on high-cost health plans. We are projecting that unless anything changes, as the law was written in 2010, that the city would be impacted by the excise tax as early as 2019. So you'll see that that's listed there as an estimate of $56,000, and it jumps up to $162,000 the next year.
You mean 2020? Because it's under 2020.
FY 2020 would be the first year that it would be impacted, and fiscal year 2021 it would jump up to 162.
Okay, so for the purpose of the people who are watching us now, in order, because of federal rules, essentially, in order for people to get the best of health care plans, those plans are going to be taxed to pay, I assume, for lesser health care plans.
Right, so the Affordable Care Act expanded coverage to a lot of people who didn't have coverage before, and so this is one of the revenue generators for that expansion. And so it sets a target threshold of a cost threshold, and if a plan's costs exceed that, then the tax is 40% on the amount above the threshold.
The excise tax is going to drive up the cost of, presumably drive up the cost of the city plan if everything stays the same, essentially.
That's correct.
And therefore, either the city or the individuals or both are going to have to pick up that those costs in the future.
That's correct.
Making health care even more costly for.
Yeah, I mean, it's a problem, and almost every employer is looking at this very closely, because they might not all employers are looking to hit it maybe as early as you are, but certainly by 2025, I'd say almost every employer health plan will be impacted by it.
Okay, thank you.
And what are the things that make a plan Cadillac or platinum or whatever phrase you want to use?
Well,
just in general, not.
So it's interesting that the Affordable Care Act doesn't describe it in terms of plan design. They describe it based on a cost threshold. So they're assuming, I guess, if it's a high cost plan, then it must have rich benefits. If you do look at your benefits in the level plan, your level plan benefits are richer than the platinum plans that are available on the state and federal exchanges. So, if you look at it that way, it would be considered a very rich, high-cost plan.
Define rich.
So the richest plan on the exchange, the Platinum plan, has a 90% actuarial value, which means if you look at an aggregate expected claims for a group, that the plan pays 90% of those claims and participants pay 10%. Your level plan comes in at around 94%.
Okay. So it's sort of an overall net basis that they figure, not specific arrays of...
Yeah, so that's looking at a... So the exchange plans are all set by these metal tiers, platinum, gold, silver, and bronze. So they look at this actuarial value. So, but the actual excise tax isn't necessarily looking at what your actual value is. It's looking at what your plan costs are, which, you know, are somewhat related to the richness of the plan design, because if you had a less rich plan, then your rates would be less.
I mean, if we went, took everybody out onto the government market and locked them all into the best plan in the government market, it wouldn't get as good of a plan as we're offering now.
That's correct.
And we get penalized twice in the process, once because our plan is of a nature that some of that cost collection goes to fund other entities that don't offer decent plans. And the other way we get hit is that we absorb through our contract language any of those increases that occur.
Right, and of particular consideration kind of along those points, there are right now significant limitations on changes that this body can make due to current contract language.
And I found it odd when you say that, because in the memo, it says no mayor and council action is required at this time.
Not at this point,
And I read that, and I hear us talking about 2019. And here's the reality, what I think will occur. We won't address it till 2019. We won't address it because, frankly speaking, the employees who participate in that process aren't going to want to step down in that plan before that penalty actually arrives at the doorstep, and the cost associated with that, we're going to keep eating anyway until we get there, because that issue won't be pressed, and then it's a matter of let's just, and you know, I know, while I appreciate the presentation to this body, based on that synopsis, the reality is the next administration is simply accepting that they're going to have to debate with those employees at that time who's going to eat that $55,000, which at that time is going to be
And at more that than point, that. You're already in the measurement period, and that's why we feel it's so important, at least for mayor and council, to be aware of it now. Because as we do the budget, we look
for
at the three-year projections.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, I disagree, because I think there are contracts now, but those contracts mm-hmm. expire this summer, correct?
June 30th for all four.
Yeah,
but most of our contracts only run, right now, they're only running like a two-year, right?
The last one was a three-year cycle.
Right.
Before that was 1 year.
Which gets us to the year before or the year of that item taking place.
Right, but the richness of the plan costs us more than the fine. I mean, I'm sure if you looked at the cost, the difference between 90% and 94% is going to be more than what that fine is. So you have double reasons to try to get at that early before that.
Well, I don't hear a discussion that we're just trying to drop from 94 to 90.
Well, I just threw that out as an example.
I know, but what I'm saying is I hear a discussion that we're not going to save any money by still sitting at the top. We're actually going to continue to be penalized in that process, because we're going to be in that top tier. I mean, the it appears to me the government construct of this entire sort of scale is to push folks towards the middle.
Well, what would it take to get out of the penalty situation?
So
I mean, starting, let's say now, and or in that year, but which it seems to me it's too late to do it in that year, you want to phase into it.
That's what most employers do. Most employers are adjusting their plan designs now, because the nature of health plan inflation is if you wait till 2019, you would have to make very drastic cuts.
Exactly.
Right then.
Which is why it's odd to me when the memo says no action is needed now, because to me, and I understand the sensitivities of the discussion.
They mean literally today.
Right.
Literally today.
Now. Well, not like the next couple months.
I mean, we should have been having these conversations, you know what I mean, already.
Right, and we've had these annual reviews where we've talked about, like, the P4 fees.
With all due respect, everybody, when I hear that what we're talking about is federal government potential penalties coming into effect in 5 to 10 years, I think we're doing just fine having this information today and discussing it and taking action on it this year. I don't think we're behind. And my guess is, having been on the exchange and seeing what you're talking about, I can't imagine us getting down to a silver or a bronze plan, which is what's being discussed. I don't see that happening. I see what silver and bronze plans are, and I don't think many of us sitting at this table would be real impressed to have that for ourselves.
Right.
And so if the reality is, you know, my concern is we're sitting here in, I'd be much happier discussing this next year after the election. And not only this election, but actually much more importantly, the federal election, to see what happens and where things are going. I completely agree, Kristen, that when you look at where we have been on this chart since 2008, yeah, things have got to change. And I think what's got to change is a combination. You aren't going to solve this problem by reducing the plan down to a bronze plan. And
just so you don't have to pay the tax.
And you're not going to solve this problem by telling the employees they're going to bear the brunt of the entire increase. Having said that, I'll tell you how else you're not going to solve this problem. You're not going to solve this problem by maintaining the same plan we have and maintaining the same employee-employer contributions that we have. That you're not going to solve.
That's what
it.
I think I've been saying for 2 years now
is
what's our ceiling? And again, I have no doubt that 3 months from now, during the start of our budget discussions, I'm going to ask the same exact question again. What's our ceiling?
Well, in all due respect, where we've been at, though, it to ask that question before this year is just discussions, because we're locked in under the employee union contracts up until this July. That's my point.
Right.
Whether we wanted to change it earlier, should have, could have, would have, is somewhere irrelevant to the reality of we have binding agreements that are valid through July.
Whoa. We have binding agreements with our unions that say on an annual basis we will review this as a committee and determine changes, and if 3 out of 5 agree to those, we move forward. It doesn't say we review it once every 3 years, and then at that third year during a union renegotiation, we do it. It says 3 out of 5, if they agree, we make the changes.
I understand
on an annual
that.
Basis.
And the reality is, that's if they agree, and there is absolutely no stick whatsoever to make them agree, and I can't conceive. If I were a fiduciary representing a union that had that language, I can't conceive under the circumstances why I would give up what I had until I had to. You just said You just said we weren't. Nobody was going to look at the thing until 2019.
But for 2 years, we've been having this discussion. At least I've been in my mind, I think, and have said repeatedly, it comes down to two things: taxes or manpower. And we are here at this point now, again, for coming on the third year in a row of the same exact scenario. It's taxes or manpower. And those costs aren't decreasing, and we are definitely continuing to eat the entirety of those cost increases for a plan that, as is pointed out, is well above the highest plan.
And I think I just said that a solution is not to continue down that road. That is going to have to change, and everybody around this table, I think, recognizes that.
The first we can change it is the summer of 2016.
Right.
We're sitting here looking and getting the facts about things that we're going to have to be considering between now and then. And then there will be tough decisions.
I agree. We're getting those facts again.
But a year ago, we couldn't have acted on it.
I also would say this.
We can't. There's a contract.
I would also point out, and I think
we should be very astute in saying, ultimately the responsibility is going to rest on the elected officials. I would certainly like to believe, however, that the decision-making process can be done with our employee bargaining units. I would certainly hope they're not going to come to the table looking at what we're looking at right now and expecting that nothing's going to change.
Right.
Because if that's an expectation, it's, you know,
that's part of the good faith, is recognizing the fiscal situation that the city is in and recognizing the level of contribution that the city,
the commitment the city's been trying to make. What everybody is trying to look at is something, and the reason I emphasize the need to have the employee groups discuss this with us versus them just saying to us, there's nothing to discuss.
Right.
It is because I believe the only solution is a combination of potential plan changes and employee contribution, and that affects the employees directly. The employees need to tell
us. Sure, they're stakeholders. They need to be involved in that process.
Take the position that we're not going to change a plan and we're not going to change the contributions. Right. If they do that, then they no longer, they will live with whatever the elected officials do. There's certainly this feeling, each one of us individually has our own life issues of how good of insurance you want and how much you're willing to pay for. Mm-hmm. And that's wherein I would look for our employee groups to come in and say, listen, we need to work to come to this medium. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's like a court and it's left up to other people. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I would like to think that these are going to be actual discussions and just not a message back to us.
Has the question ever been given to the committee?
Yes, actually in several reviews we've given them some alternate scenarios, and there's been no interest to change the plan structure from the current level plan, we have made vendor changes in order to save money. There have been small tweaks to save money. We've changed vendors in pretty much every carrier of healthcare, dental, excess coverage. We've changed all of them to try to save money.
But as the governmental program continues to wrap more closely mm-hmm. around that private industry, those changes are going to be few and far between because they're all going to be mm-hmm. sort of yeah. leveled on that playing field.
Right. That's
Lou, I think you make some excellent points. And I do. It does need to be pointed out, though, that somebody's got to pay for this stuff,
exactly.
and our tax base is not growing. In fact, it could be falling. We'll see. No, pretty soon. And therefore, in order to pay for this stuff in the long run, it may require a tax increase. And I don't know that that's really in the cards either.
Well, go ahead and proceed with your presentation.
Okay. So the next page shows you some possible changes to the level plan that could help reduce the city's cost and also, you know, still result in a very competitive health plan. So these changes are pretty modest. They're not going to get you anywhere down to what a silver or a bronze plan would look like. So you can see your current benefits for the level plan. Alternative one, the most modest changes, and that is really in line with what a platinum plan on the exchange would look like. Those plan changes, we're estimating the savings would be $167,000. If you also eliminated the waiver credits, you'd be looking at $245,000 savings per year. Alternative two is passing on a bit more cost sharing to the employees, but still this is right in between a gold and a platinum plan on the exchange, so it's still a very competitive mainstream type plan design. And that provides more significant savings. And then the third alternative is really a gold type of a plan under the exchange. So still kind of rich plans compared to what people are buying out on the state and federal exchanges. So we did include the eliminating the waiver credit as an option here. That is not a prevalent practice for employers any longer to pay people to not enroll in the plan. It can also impact whether your plans are considered affordable under the Affordable Care Act, so it could kind of gets worked into that equation, and looking at what people pay and then what they're giving up by not getting that credit.
Can I ask just a really stupid question?
Mm-hmm.
Is it even a choice for us to say, we're not going to provide health coverage, here's your voucher or whatever, go out on the market and find it yourself?
So there's no voucher that you would be providing. You could say, we're not offering health coverage, and then you get assessed a $2,000 per employee fine or tax, mm-hmm, for not offering health coverage. So, you know, that's certainly a lot less expensive than what your cost of health coverage is. Mm-hmm. Most employers haven't jumped at that because they still want to offer health benefits to be competitive.
Right. I just wanted to put that out there. That's always an option, too.
Yes, that is always an
option.
That's
not one that we're really exploring.
Right.
Yeah, I wouldn't recommend that at this point.
Plus, I'm not saying I recommend it.
$2,000 tax penalty.
Right.
That's money that doesn't even go to employees.
Right.
That's not bronze or silver. What would that be?
I don't know.
Lead.
Lead belly. I just wanted to point, I'm not advocating that either. I'm just saying that I just didn't know what the status of that was.
It's a potential
tax penalty, an ongoing tax penalty.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
It takes place every year.
Yeah, and per employee.
It will be indexed each year. Right, it'll be indexed each year.
But these are before the penalty, right? These are savings before the penalty.
Before the excise tax?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Hopefully these would help you.
These would help us
delay,
get that.
Right.
These are even bigger. Look at these numbers are more significant than even that estimated tax, isn't it? I mean, I think we have to cut out, you know, again, we're way beyond even the best government plan, so it sounds like.
Mm-hmm.
Don, I'm sorry, I just want to point out that the numbers here are larger than that estimated in that penalty.
Right. But what's the benchmark year?
The benchmark year? 2014?
And that's forever.
The benchmark for what? Sorry.
The $2,000 penalty.
Oh, that's for 2015. So it'll go up slightly each year.
Well, okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
That's okay.
Please go ahead.
Like I said, by the time 2019 gets here, it won't be 55, it'll be 100. You know what I mean? It's just going to keep growing.
So that's what, you know, a combination of plan design changes would look like. On the next page, we just kind of gave you an a la carte list of potential savings for different deductible levels, coinsurance amounts, out-of-pocket maximum. Towards the bottom in bold, we also show you if you really wanted to be drastic and eliminate your level plan altogether and have everybody only offered the plus plan, which is your current high deductible plan that has a health savings account tied to it. So that is another option. Again, you can eliminate the waiver credit, or if you're not comfortable with that, you could cut it in half so that it would be $10 a week instead of $20 a week. So there's really a variety of options. It just depends on, again, thinking about what's your budget, you know, where do you want your health plan costs to be, and then we can try to work in that direction.
Do you have any estimation? You know, you showed us a chart where 2006 it was like $7,900, and now in 2015 it's almost $14,000. So while you say in the last 5 years it's increased 10%, really in the last 10 years it's doubled.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess I'm just curious if you have any estimations out there in the industry where, you know, 3 years from now, because these plans will become somewhat more marginalized,
mm-hmm,
with the industry, if those 10% aren't going to be 10% any longer. In other words, let's say we do nothing. We say, you know what, we'll take our chances with, you know, with what may come in the next 3 years, and we'll deal with it in 2019, and we'll see what the penalty is if it's, you know, things are still operating the same way, and they're not. And you used the word drastic earlier. I guess my curiosity is, we take that route, or at least some you know, slow form of it, and 2019 rolls around, it's not 10% anymore. I mean, I guess in my mind I'm thinking, you know what I mean, you're going to be even more hard-pressed to find an entity out there that wants to participate in that, given all of the governmental strangulation of it. It won't be 10%, it'll be 25%. And I'm just curious if you have any of those inclinations in the industry to that effect.
No, I mean, I don't have any data that would support that health plan trend is going to increase that dramatically.
I mean, for those specific types of plans.
For the richest of the plans?
Mm-hmm.
No, we're not predicting that.
And I would point out, when we talk about this, and when we talk about the, you know, some of the vibrations I hear about the heart of the Affordable Care Act. You know, you mentioned that slide.
Mm-hmm.
There's a reason we have the Affordable Care Act. There was a time, and it's coming to a degree, when this was just becoming totally out of control. And if you look at this chart, when it goes out of control, it's essentially between 2008 in 2011, before the Affordable Care Act, and not necessarily with our chart, but with the yellow chart.
Mm-hmm.
And I may note with our chart, we had quite an aberration, which somebody needs to get a pat on the back for, because we're about the only place that I've ever seen where we had a reduction in healthcare costs over a one-year period where it actually was reduced. Mm-hmm. We seem to have certainly made up for it in the following year somehow or another, but my point being is the reason this Affordable Care Act came about is because healthcare was totally out of control. It was absolutely out of control, not only for a private citizen trying to get health insurance, but it was getting out of control for government agencies and employers. I am hopeful, maybe not so optimistic, but hopeful, with the next election, that maybe we will have a Congress that decides that instead of just saying no to everything, they will try to do some repair work to those things that need to be repaired and see if we can get this even flatter instead of larger, Kristen, because that's what seems to be happening versus what your prediction, which is that's going to spike. This graph indicates the exact opposite. And I would like to think that that's the direction things are going to go, but who knows? As we sit here and discuss this, you know, I'll just mention it just fits in with this insanity of defined benefit plans and pensions. I mean, you're talking, you think this is crazy. I don't know how anybody in God's green earth really thinks that you can figure out what you got to contribute to pay a defined benefit plan 30 years down the road.
But the anomaly in that graph, if I'm not mistaken, happened about the year that we made significant changes in the healthcare plan and offered the level sort of into the process of the, I forget what you called it, whatever the higher one is.
And or the waiver, probably. I mean, I'm not sure what we did then to do it, but
the waiver's been around.
There were some.
It's when we offered the level plan into the process to address.
That was in 2009 when we offered the level and the plus.
Right.
So when you see like the aberrations with your plan kind of going up and down, so when you look at a group your size, it's heavily impacted by high claimant activity. So there's definitely, and that's just, you know, degree of luck whether you have a year when there's not much high claim activity versus when you do. So that's why it's good to look at it kind of like on average what's happened in 5 years, because some years you're going to have ups and downs. So there's going to be years when you've got good years because you haven't had, you know, a super high claimant, you know, like $200,000, and then other years where you might have two of those, and then it really kind of throws things out of whack. But that's what explains some of those ups and downs there.
Thank you. It's an excellent presentation.
When you say on this chart, I guess it's the next to last chart.
Uh-huh.
Potential changes.
Uh-huh.
But alternative three is still what you would call a gold plan.
Yes.
Yeah, I can assure you, you get on the health exchange and start looking.
You'll see
plan.
Deductibles
and
out of pocket.
Yeah, you're going to get down to a silver plan. I don't think there's anybody sitting at this table that would find that we would find it acceptable to have as for our insurance.
No.
I do think on your last slide, the future healthcare considerations, It seems to me the lowest hanging fruit is that waiver credit. That seems to me to be pretty obvious that that needs to be eliminated. But this increase on focusing on wellness and prevention, I think that is huge, huge, when it comes to reducing the cost of these chronic conditions, because those are very easily reversible through behavior modification. So the healthier the workforce we have, you know, that's, it goes back to every employee is a stakeholder and can either add value or take away value from the city. And I think that's an important point, you know, for all employees to consider. All of us, really.
Absolutely. Workers' comp costs, productivity, absenteeism, it all ties into it.
Any other questions or comments? This is obviously a topic that stokes the passions of everyone around this table.
Well, I the only other thing I would say is I did note there were various alternatives that you had in the earlier screen that may not save a fortune, but seem very palatable. For instance, raising the deductible, raising the copay from $20 to $30. Mm-hmm. You know, that should be palatable for the world here. There, you know, when I looked at the first jump ups instead of the third or fourth, they all seemed to be something that would be palatable. They were savings if you added them up somewhere, you know, in a six-figure range. But there were things that it looks like could be done to start doing what we're talking about, making changes, and even if they were minimal to begin with, some recognition, you make some minor changes, you make some minor percentage changes in contributions, and you start changing things. And I think that's what we need to start doing now, is having that mindset that that neither one of these two ends are a solution. It's got to be somewhere in the middle.
I think we should talk a little bit about how we want to approach this and address it over the next 6 months. I mean, one option, it seems to me, one option is to have the city manager look at this and work with the employee groups through Karen and so forth and make a proposal. Another one would be for her to work with us as part of the budget process, which is the end of March is when that comes out. Another one would be to work with us sort of jointly or simultaneously with that. But that the problem with that for the city administrator is she doesn't know where, you know, her bottom line's going to come out unless we tell her well in advance, you know, at the end of March. But I think we ought to think about how we get there from here. Because, you know, these are negotiating issues. They're also issues that are important to the whole staff, and they're important to all of us. So, you know, I guess I'd be willing to have the city manager working through the staff and working through the healthcare committee make a recommendation, which would give us a launching point. It's always much easier to discuss where you're going when you have a launching point and you know what you're weighing it against, like here's our budget situation, to me, rather than a vacuum.
I agree with you, Barton, and I think that is in place right now, and if, given the fact that it is in place, that we should take advantage of it and use it and not ignore it. I think for us to unilaterally say, well, we're going to flush that process down right now would be a mistake, and I know you're not,
but
the opposite.
But what I'm saying is, that we have the city administrator make a recommendation, working, bouncing it off the committee, but not necessarily being wed to it, just getting reaction, getting feedback, but not taking dictation or not taking anything. But
the committee would review and
can review, and if they say, well, we just can't go anywhere, then make a recommendation. I guess that's where I'd like to have a.
I think it should go to the
committee. Have that, and that way you know how it fits against all the other budget changes that might be. I guess that's. Are we comfortable with
that? I'm comfortable with that.
If you're comfortable with that.
Yeah. And as far as timing for implementation, if we're looking at changes for July 1, Becky, what would you recommend having a final decision by?
I think you want to have your final decisions by mid to late March.
Ooh.
So.
But those aren't final decisions. I mean, it would come to us. It would come to us as part of a budget, and we might take
right in order to roll it out to employees.
We might say, well, we'd like to make this a little bit richer or poorer and do this over here, like we always do with the budget. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't we have time to do that?
Well, if you do your open enrollment in May.
Yeah, so that's pushing it. Yeah, you'd have to have it done by March. So we need to get
or there's a way the to defer the change until August or have a rolling start.
Well, we could defer the denouement until another time too.
Good suggestion.
We've had lots of things to do between now and
it'll be a busy winter.
It's going to be a fun year.
I think to do it in a budget context to me is the best way, because that way you know it
has to be.
You're weighing it against the other options and the other alternatives.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And approaching it in a vacuum.
Sure. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you. I think I like Cadillac and Chevrolet better than
the next item on our agenda is the Community Action Council, and I'm going to invite Mr. Jordy Newman and Ms. Diana Fulkiren.
Hello.
I don't think I pronounced your name right, but it's
Fulcherons.
Fulcherons, thank you. With a name like Iceberg's.
Yeah, thank you for having us.
I wanted to start by saying thank you for being here, and you know, this is not the first time I've met with Mr. Newman or Diana, and so I'm going to turn it over to you to talk about the latest with the Community Action Council.
Well, I spoke with the mayor, I guess, several weeks ago now, just to have the opportunity to kind of explain the permanent supportive housing program. There's a lot of misinformation regarding this program, and I just thought it was best to inform the mayor and council how this actually works. This program is funded by HUD as part of the continuum of care, and it is specifically for single homeless individuals. And this is a nationwide program. Every county in the state has it. So this isn't anything unique to Hagerstown, but it certainly serves a population that needs this. The people have to apply for this program. There are guidelines for them. There are rules once they're in the program. If they violate those rules, they are removed from the program. So there is incentive for the people involved to really improve themselves. The purpose of this program is to make them self-sustaining. It's not to be a long-term care. It's more to get them back on their feet and be productive members of the community. Because it is a HUD program, there are some requirements that we need to follow. One is it needs to be on a bus route, because nobody currently in the program, and I don't know if ever, have had their own transportation. So just simple things like getting groceries can be a challenge. They also all go through background checks with criminal, and their income obviously is also verified to qualify for the program. And they all have to have individual rooms that lock. They can have shared kitchens or bathrooms, but they all have to have individual living quarters. Previously, the program had 48 units, and we dropped it to 33 over the past several months. We do have a waiting list. There were 24 people that moved to the East Washington location, and we have a waiting list, and we will be filling those spots within the next month. So we will have the full 33 people in the program. Anything major I left out?
Well, explain a little bit between case management versus the housing, because I know, and the direction you're going is you're looking at acquiring a property of your own for this program. And I guess we should mention that program was formerly in the Dagmar
Correct.
And because you've now moved to West Washington, your goal is to eventually seek, this is not a permanent housing, supportive housing program. You're looking at acquiring property, but the HUD rules don't allow you to do case management and own the property.
Correct. So at this point, Potomac Case Management will be supplying the counseling. Everyone in the program
receives counseling.
No.
Prior to when did they start
today.
That?
December 1st.
Okay. So today
so
was
previously this, CAC had been
was doing
providing
case management
the
because
case
you didn't
management.
Own
correct because
the
housing was done at the Dagmar. So that's
right.
Our incentive to move. Each member of this program receives counseling on a weekly basis or more if necessary, and that is also a requirement. Everyone has something that they're working on to improve themselves, and counseling is a major part of that. If they violate those rules, they're also removed from the program.
When they're removed from the program, what happens to them?
Well, they search for other housing.
They're just
which,
on their own, basically.
Yes.
Do the case management stick with them, or is the case management tied to the housing?
For our particular program, when we were offering case management services, we had limited staff, and that case management would cease once they left the program. Most of our clients that were in the program were also receiving mental health services through other providers in the area, and that case management service would carry over. With Potomac Case Management Services, they offer a full spectrum of case management services, not just tied to this particular program. So under this particular model, these individuals, if they did leave the program, they would be able to retain the same case manager as they transition to something else. So.
Question. I'm not sure when I read your sort of frequently asked question thing, and then I go down to the actual criteria and application requirements. When I read what I would call the FAQs, it says requirements be able to pass criminal background check.
Yes.
When I go down to the application itself, it says criminal background and references will be considered.
Right.
So I don't know what passing a background check, criminal background check means, given the fact that it seems like, and I may be exaggerating and I may not be, but it seems like 80% of the Dagmar were sex offenders residing there.
Okay, well that's in itself is it's an extreme exaggeration, but specifically within our program.
Could you pull your microphone?
Oh,
closer,
certainly.
Thank you.
Specifically within the, and you have to remember that this program at its height was only a portion of the individuals that were at the Dagmar itself. So in speaking.
And I understand
that,
and that's why I'm saying. I don't mean to imply.
Sure.
I just know when you looked at the residents at the Dagmar, there
yes.
were a substantial number, certainly, that fit that category.
Right.
I'm not saying they were CAC residents.
Well, sure. And most recently, we occupied the college dorm side of the Dagmar, so our clients were
so
totally separate
criminal
from
background
the others.
Check, what does that
sure.
mean?
Well, let me, to clarify that particular piece, in order to qualify for this particular program, they would pull a background check to make sure that people coming into the program could be supported by a program. So if somebody had an extreme violent history, had extraordinary chronic mental health issues that were creating instability that our case managers couldn't handle, we wouldn't take them into the program because we wouldn't want to place somebody in a situation that would either cause harm to themselves or harm to people around them. And so our background screenings, it's having a criminal background wouldn't necessarily exclude you from the program, but it would help us direct whether or not this would be an appropriate placement for this individual.
So when you say pass the criminal background check, it's really, it means
it's a screening.
Are the circumstances such that you would be able to manage them or not?
Exactly. And specifically moving to the East Washington location, it's directly across from a daycare center, so no sex offenders will be able to, registered sex offenders will be able to participate in the program anyway, simply because of that location. We would never, state, federal, all the laws would
right.
preclude that from happening. And so.
I don't have a problem at all with what you're saying, even a little bit. I would note, though, that
yes.
the literature is somewhat deceiving. When
okay.
someone reads pass a criminal background check, I think the majority of the public reads that to mean if you have a criminal record, you're not getting in. And I need to add, I don't agree with that at all. I absolutely understand, and when I see the criteria that involves, potential substance abuse that is being treated, and I understand all, by definition, you're going to have a lot of people with criminal background. So I have no criticism of the way you're doing it. But I would change that wording, because I think when you hold that out, people believe that, and then when they see that that's not what happens, then they wonder about the veracity of everything else.
I will say, though,
I have no criticism of the way you're doing it at all.
Well, and really, these were internal documents that we just supplied so you had a better understanding.
No problem.
As though you were applying for the program yourself, you would understand. Not that you need to, but that you would understand what's involved.
I would note the third page in the packet under, I think this is part of your application, number 7 says, passage of the criminal background check, but underneath it says, criminal background references will be considered. So,
no, that's why I said. That wording is fine. The wording that says that will be considered is fine. The wording in
pass.
The previous that says you'll pass
open
it.
To interpretation, right?
Yes.
Well, and I think the interpretation is one that they don't mean to be coming forward, and that in the long term can hurt the program. That's my whole point.
Well, and we want people to be successful. We want to bring people in that week and help. Because if you look at the second page, 87.5% of the people that leave this program do not return to homelessness. So the idea is
that. Can you repeat that? Can you say that again?
87.56% of the people that leave the program do not return to homelessness.
Mm-hmm. I think
people
that's
that successfully complete the program.
No. Anyone that leaves.
If people leave on their own for whatever reason, that's counted against the program. Or if they're removed from the program because they violated the rules, that's also
included. So this includes anyone who has ever exited the program from January 1st, 2009.
And I think the name of the program is deceiving in itself because it's permanent supportive housing, but then at the very beginning you said this is temporary.
Right. And so to explain that a little bit further, within the world of HUD and the very specific language that they use, they divvied up housing into a number of different categories. There was emergency housing that's supposed to provide temporary shelter in extreme circumstances for 60 days or less. Then there's transitional housing, which is supposed to provide housing from that 60-day period up to 2 years as families and individuals need a little bit extra support. They were trying to create an additional category of housing where they identified individuals in families in the community that needed additional supports that weren't necessarily timed out. And so they labeled it as permanent supportive housing, but the thrust of the program is to stabilize individuals and families who have chronic or long-term issues with stable, affordable housing for them for a period of time so that they can then graduate from the program into housing of their own.
Any children involved in this program?
In our particular program, no. So there are three permanent supportive housing programs in Washington County. Ours is the only one that serves individuals. The other two programs serve families.
And where are those?
Those are scattered site programs. So families are placed around the city and the county, and the agencies contract with the individual landlords.
And I do think it's really important to repeat what you've already said because of, believe me, all of us, I think, have heard the comments about the Dagmar. And what I said is a comment we hear frequently about the sex offender issue. And I think what you have said needs to be heard loud and clear. And I understand what you're saying, knowing what the law is, and that is, you can't house a sex offender where you are doing this housing. So,
That's correct. So
you will be able to clean the slate of having this intermix of the folks at the Dagmar that you're not placing. And I'm assuming that that's also going to be much better for the people you're providing services to. I don't think anybody's real impressed with you all being forced to intermix your clientele even in the vicinity of that clientele. So I think that's important, and people need to really hear that loud and clear.
If I could, before you respond to that, I would like to mention that
the current manager of the Dagmars here, Mr. Kumar, and I met with him just last week, and he reported to me that as of very soon, there will actually be zero. Is it zero?
It's as of right now, so zero sex offenders.
Right now, there are
zero
sex offenders at the Dagmar.
The public needs to hear this, okay? If we can't get this out to the public, then this image of the Dagmar is never going to change. And I know that you would like it to change as much as we would like it to change.
And so very soon, I think it will be helpful to invite Mr. Kumar to come and update.
I think it would be wonderful.
The whole council and the public on the work he's doing there. Because I do think that he deserves and his people deserve a lot of credit for at least attempting to turn that property around. Based on what we have outlined as our vision for how to revitalize downtown, I do think...
Well, Mr. Kumar has already made a statement of how he has turned it around to a substantial degree. And that's going
I just
to
wanted to point that
time.
Out before we continue on with the discussion, because I want to allow you to respond.
Sure.
But I thought that was worth pointing out.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and in the history of this particular program, it happened to this particular pot of funding for this particular type of housing came about at the time when the YMCA in downtown was closing. Mm-hmm. And so the individuals from the YMCA were transferred to one of the only congregate living establishments for individuals in the city. And I don't know if anyone at that particular time saw that as a permanent solution because of the fact that you're taking a population that has stability issues and placing them in a larger population where there are other instability issues that are presented. And we all appreciate
it. It's like a bad chemistry experiment.
Yes, it was. And from a therapeutic standpoint for these individuals that have... mental health issues, physical disability issues, and or substance abuse issues, it was seen as being a better option to house them separately where the influences around them in their housing could be a little bit more controlled and contained. And so it's one of the reasons why the transition happened to take this particular population out of a larger housing situation.
Well, and also it seems to me that you're making a very calculated strategy to focus on owning the housing and outsourcing the program management or the case management. And I think that is obviously a strategy that you're just implementing with this move now.
And it helps that our case manager is retiring at the end of the month.
Yes. So kind of he's been with the program.
Forces the issue a little bit.
Yeah.
And I would like to note, too, because I know it's been a topic of interest for council members about this idea of a housing summit. I've talked with you about it, and certainly staff and I have been meeting with smaller stakeholders, but leading up to what will be a housing summit probably early next year, involving, it'll be a public process. It's not going to be a secret meeting or anything, but certainly we're formulating a steering committee now to put it together, and we'll be inviting many of the of the stakeholders and certainly the public to participate in that, because this is a huge issue for the city of Hagerstown. Housing, when we look at the riots that were happening in Baltimore and that have happened throughout history, I go back to the 1967 riots and the Kerner Commission that came out of that. And, the police can do everything they can do to enforce the law and keep people safe, but ultimately the iceberg the police interaction with the community is the tip of the iceberg. The iceberg is jobs, housing, and education.
Sure.
So by at least addressing this issue of housing and putting this at the forefront as a priority for this mayor and council, we're at least attempting to chip away at that iceberg or get to the root of it so we can come up with a plan that is, again, a shared vision for the community about how we approach all the different needs of housing, not just at the lower end of the spectrum, but all the way up through the various strata of our local economy, so that we're meeting needs and growing the city as we know it should and could grow. So I just wanted to point that out, that we are moving in that direction, and we'll be getting more of that. As we get everything refined, I'll be giving the council and the public more updates about that, but it is on its way.
Well, and to make you aware, we also have low to moderate income housing for families. We own 19 properties between the city and the county that provide Again, through a HUD program, allows us to purchase them, do the renovations. So we're taking buildings that are falling into disrepair in the city and purchasing them, doing the rehab work, and then renting them to, again, these are people that have to qualify. They have to provide their income. It needs to be low to moderate income. And then they have a place to live where, if weren't for this program, they would struggle.
Is that homeless, housing for the homeless?
No.
Or just housing for low and moderate?
Housing for low to moderate income. We're one of the two CHOTOs in the state that enables us to purchase.
Sorry, CHOTO, you said?
Yeah, CHOTO, Community Housing Development Organization. It's a specification that allows us to qualify for the federal funding that he was mentioning.
The other one being HNDP?
Garrett County, I believe.
Oh, you're saying in Western Maryland?
No, in
the entire state.
Oh, in the entire state.
Yes.
Gotcha.
So we essentially acquire one property per year and do the restoration and then rent it out. And the plan is to do one a year as long as the federal funding is available.
As long as Ted Bruce doesn't get left.
Okay. Mr. Munson, then Mr. Brewer.
I'd like to ask a series of questions if I could.
Sure.
But I first want to make the statement. You own a property up on West Side Avenue. You know.
337 West
correct.
Side Avenue.
I had innumerable complaints about that property before your time. The foliage along the sidewalk became so overgrown that people couldn't even walk on the sidewalk anymore. And I really had to go to our enforcement people to get something done about it. I hope that you all will pursue, in those terms, I hope that you all will pursue a better path in the future.
Well, we actually hired a property manager. She started Monday, and one of her main functions is to inspect every property each month to not only make sure the outside is up to code, but to make sure the inside is protecting our property as well.
Okay.
We are taking that internally, and that will be addressed.
That's a good step in that direction.
So that's something that previously had not been done, and you said she started Monday?
Right. Well,
or he started Monday?
Well,
so historically speaking, and both Mr. Newman and I are relatively new to the agency, but it's my understanding that this acquisition process started within the last decade and really happened at such a slow pace that the property management duties were allocated to a staff member who was doing them on a part-time basis. He did a two-year transition into retirement, during which time the property management duties were decreased, and last year, for 2015, we took the step of taking those duties entirely away from him and contracting with Bowen Realty.
Yes.
To actually do the property management, because we didn't have the staff in-house to do it at the time, to both stabilize our tenancy and our occupancy rates, but then also to get some of these issues addressed on a more systematic basis.
It sounds like you see that as a priority then.
Yes, absolutely. This was seen as something that needed significant help and very quickly, so we contracted with a professional company for a year to get things stabilized and are now in a position where the properties are bringing in enough revenue that we're able to support that functionality within the house. And so we're hoping to use her services. She has property management experience with other landlords in property management companies in Hagerstown. So she's familiar with city code regulations. She's familiar with kind of the lay of land in this area. And so we're hoping that she's able to bring that expertise in-house so that we're able to have more additional controls over what's happening and how it's happening and our ability to be responsive towards any issues that come up at our properties.
Okay, can I finish mine?
Sure, yes.
So, at your property on Washington Street, there will be no sex offenders, period.
Correct.
Correct?
Yes.
No matter who, even if the President of the United States recommends them.
Yeah, even if
be a crime, dude. Not allowed to be there permanently.
Okay.
That's the answer.
There will be no murderers there.
Yes, I mean, yes. That would be seen as someone.
There would be no rapists there.
Well, that would be a sex offender.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, that's.
And I met with the director across the street at the nursing school.
Well,
I went over and knocked on her door
pretty damn important. Yeah.
Yeah, I went over and knocked on her door because I was like, look, let me explain to you what's going on, because she had already heard from a crossing guard of all these horrible things
you
were doing.
I'm sure.
It's like, let me sit down. And I spoke with her and explained to her what the program was, and she was very comfortable with it when I left.
Okay. What's it going to take in terms of antisocial behavior for someone to be put out of your program?
They have a very specific, and now that Potomac Case Management is taking it over, they have a list of rules that it's a one and done situation. I mean, if you violate the program, you're gone. So it's not a situation where you're going to be able to habitually break the rules and stay there.
Okay, let me get a little more specific then.
Mm-hmm.
There's a restaurant down there nearby called Burkett's Restaurant.
Sure.
It's a nice little facility. They serve good food.
Okay.
I go down there for lunch fairly often. If one of your clients goes over there, decides he or she doesn't like the food, raises hell, starts throwing food perhaps, or gets carried away, is that sort of behavior going to have any effect on whether or not they remain in your program in the future?
I guess it would depend on if the
charges
folks at Burkett's knew to report it to, I mean, some.
I'll guarantee you Mr. Burkett will be on the phone with the police with the captain back there before the incident is resolved, I can tell you that.
All right, and I believe we have a working relationship with the police that if criminal incidents happen within this particular population, it'll be something that can be reported to the staff and something that will be monitored. And I don't believe additional criminal
activity. At minimum, they'll be counseled, though, right?
Oh, yeah. So one of the benefits about moving to Potomac Case Management Services is because of the type of agency they are, and I can't remember, it's a mental health service agency designation, and I can't remember the exact term. They're able to provide increased case management services because they're able to get compensated for it through whatever program silo they fit into. And so for the 33 individuals that they're going to have in the program, they're going to have 2, 3, or 4 case managers that are going to be working with these individuals, whereas with our program we had a single case manager that was trying to work with 48 individuals. And so They will be having
weekly, a lower ratio of clients.
Yeah, there will be a lower ratio, and additionally there will be the individuals in the apartments that they're in, they're also going to be having house meetings to help on a weekly basis, at least to begin with, to help resolve issues that may come up with
okay.
individual sharing.
Just two more questions.
Sure.
Do your clientele have any spendable income at all?
Any spendable income? It depends on the individuals. So the individuals in the program that have the least amount of income are dependent on TDAP. And so they receive $184, $185 a month. They will spend 30% of that as a occupancy charge for the program. And that probably constitutes 30 to 40% of the individuals in the program are within that spending category. We've had individuals who can support much higher rents. I think the highest monthly income in the program was over $1,000 of monthly income in the program. So,
okay. Last question.
Yes.
You're going to have 33 clients there. Is that correct?
That's
yes.
correct.
Do you have any plans to double up or increase the number of clients in that area?
No. They are only allowed to have one person per bedroom. So 33 is
the absolute
maximum.
You're not going to buy 6 more buildings down the street?
No.
No. No. And with this grant, each year it's specific to the number of rooms they will pay for. So this year it's 33. We couldn't go into next year and say, well, we're going to do 60 because the funding's not there.
Okay. So the only way we'd be able to do that is to close down one of the other programs, take that money, and then add it into ours. And
there is a pot of money that supports all three of these programs. So there's only so much to go around, and that's why it's divvied up the way it is.
Thank you.
Mr. Brubaker?
Yeah, we've approached my questions, but I don't think we've clearly answered them. What is the duration permitted under the permanent supportive housing?
Under permanent supportive housing, there is no maximum that you can max out. If someone is considered viable for the program and they don't have an alternative that they can transition to, they can in fact stay forever. The longest in forever, we don't want them to stay forever.
That's not the goal of the program.
That's not the goal of the program. Our average is 2 to 3 year duration. And frankly, most adults don't want to stay in a program that requires the structure that we have.
Sure.
I mean, they get
you
to the point.
You would hope not.
Right, exactly. So you don't want somebody checking up on you when you feel that you're in a stable place.
And but the bottom line is there are many people who have been institutionalized for so long that they are somewhat dependent on that kind of oversight.
And that is also another one of the positives about moving to a situation where there's a lower client to case manager caseload is that ability to move on in the program is strengthened. And so one of the other things that happened is that early on in the program, there was an emphasis to try to get people from HUD to try and get people to stay in the program forever. But then HUD, I think, realized that if they did that, there would be you would just be creating permanent housing and you wouldn't be able to fill any of the needs that came a decade later. And so the emphasis changed from having the permanent supportive housing for the time needed to stabilize the individuals and get them into a place where they could move on to something else.
Yeah, didn't this used to be called SRO or something like that?
Yeah, so single room occupancy
back
housing.
In the day.
Yeah, back in the day. So
single room occupancy, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I remember that. Is there an upper income limit?
No. You could be the President of the United States, you could be Bill Gates, and be in this program. The qualifiers are that you were homeless, either coming from the shelter or from the streets, that you have a disability, and that there's a third one, and I'm not thinking of it right now.
Have received treatment or something like that? Or
no, it's the...
But theoretically, you could have behavioral issues, but be really skilled at something that
yes,
brought in
absolutely.
Income.
Right.
But be in this because of behavioral.
Right. You have issues. You are coming to this program because you have exhausted other resources in the area. So
The thing about homelessness is that there's really two types of homelessness. There's this chronic homelessness, which
yes.
are usually your drug addicted mental health cases. And you have people who are temporarily homeless because they've come up upon some economic hardship or something like that. But usually those folks have family or other support networks that they can rely on. What you're saying is that these people that you're serving in this particular program usually have exhausted, they have no other, they don't have family or any other support networks. They've exhausted all the other
yes.
means available to them.
Right.
And this is sort of the last resort. And by getting the treatment aspect of it, by having the case management part of it, you can hopefully stabilize them to the point where that the mental health issue or addiction or whatever it is that keeps them homeless is abated so that
correct.
They put themselves in a better position to obtain viable long-term housing.
Yeah, the reality is that if you were Bill Gates, you probably wouldn't want to spend your income in this particular program. Like you would go buy an apartment building if you wanted to. So the reality is that these sorts of programs tend to serve people who are at the moment of the program either low to moderate income. And of course, the program will work with individuals as much as possible to try and augment that income.
But you don't have the authority to say, you make $3,000 a month, we can't let you in? Or can you say, we know you have issues, but that's...
Typically, someone like that would probably be screened for other programs.
A different program,
yeah.
right.
If they're coming in from
okay.
one of the shelters,
right.
then there's a reason why they don't have housing and they're making
right.
$3,000 a month. So
this is for a particular targeted population with the disability along with the homelessness problem.
Yes.
And finally, the most important question of all, what is vaping?
Oh, come on, Marty.
Oh.
Seriously?
No, I'm dating myself.
Electronic cigarettes.
Oh, those.
You've heard of that, right?
I've heard of electronic cigarettes.
Right. That's vaping.
Called vaping.
Yeah. Right. Vaporizer is the unabbreviated.
I just saw it on the list of behaviors.
I saw it too. I thought that. Mm-hmm. I never even thought about that, you know,
I
what that
maybe
was.
It was Vicks or
for
something.
Some of you, I guess it's necessary to explain, right?
Okay.
Explain it to me is that you're using marijuana and fooling their oil.
Well,
oil fooling parents with.
Yeah, I just never heard it referred to by that term. Okay.
Vaping. Well, you learn something new every day, Marty.
I said it most important of all.
Does anyone else have any questions or comments, feedback?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Go ahead. I just want, Jordy, will you make it a point to try to go up and talk to Mr. Burkett?
Certainly.
And let him know.
I'll go see him tomorrow.
Okay.
And I would point out, of all the calls since January to the Dagmar, zero have been a violation of our clientele. We had one person call on this because she was assaulted. I don't know where she was assaulted, but that was the only call at from January to present regarding this specific program.
Okay.
And just
so there's not a history
just
of
just to piggyback on that, we did receive information also recently from our chief or acting chief about the overall number of calls for service at the Dagmar have dropped significantly.
Has gone down. Yes, it
under,
has.
Under Mr. Kumar's management. So I just want to, again, give him credit for taking that bull by the horns and really doing something about it. Much appreciated.
We appreciate your coming here tonight.
Certainly.
Mr. Alshar?
Just a couple of points. You know, and I think I said this at the at least to some degree at the Homeless Coalition meeting, you know, my comments aren't overly specific to your program, what you want to do on Washington Street, the clientele that you have moved in. But, you know, when I think it was Mr. Wilson with Interfaith, last year at the State of the City asked a question, you know, what is the mayor and council going to do about, you know, the issue of homeless and housing in the city and the nonprofits that provide for it? And I answered very plainly that I'm going to hold them accountable. Mm-hmm. I think that you can certainly appreciate that, you know, the scope of the individuals, the property owners, the businesses that we serve are certainly much broader than one specific segment of the population, one specific segment of property owners. And so we have that responsibility. And I'll just point out three things here. And the first is, you know, staff gives us all these kinds of really cool maps from time to time, but this is a map of the downtown. And you can see that where you are relocating from, which is the Dagmar area over here, these little green dots are all the registered rental properties in the city. And where you're going to move clientele is over here, mm-hmm. where there's this huge concentration of all these little green dots. And I think it's to my point that I tried to bring up at the Homeless Coalition meeting and some of the demographics, because that demographic is actually in, and staff provides us the small census tract breakdowns, but this, I believe, is in District 4, or Tract 4, and in that tract, just to provide some numbers and why I keep preaching about wanting to have this housing summit with all of the agencies so that we understand our, and come to some mutual goal setting on what we want our community to be and what level we can provide services to it, so that we can sustain a good tax base and you can sustain a you know, successful clientele base. There's been a 15% population decline in that tract. It's the highest of any of the tracts in the 10-year from 2000 to 2010. It is the lowest median income at $16,000. And that's the lowest of any of the tracts. It has rental property makes up 84%. So 84% of all the housing units in that specific area, that neighborhood, are rentals. That's higher than any other tract in the city, and it actually is the lowest average unit cost at about $550. Vacant housing has increased 27%, and the marketability of homes for sale has declined to about $120,000, which is the lowest, again, of all of the tracks. And again, I don't think this speaks specifically to your agency moving 33 people into that neighborhood. It speaks to what is the impact of those movements to that neighborhood. I think it speaks even more to your indication earlier that you were looking for some sort of a permanent location, that
yes.
this is a temporary fix. And clearly to me, when I see those figures and I try and wrap my head around how to sustain, you know, a stable, viable community, neighborhood network, compounding additional individuals with significant needs in a neighborhood with those types of statistics isn't a good thing to do mm-hmm. for the community, for the neighborhood, or for your ability to serve it as an agency. It's just not. And so that's
well, where would you suggest we go?
Well, I think that that's the discussion that we have to have.
Sure.
Because another nifty map that they give us is this, which is all of those service entities mm-hmm. Throughout the downtown now, and it shows about 65 of them. If you look at that map about 15 years ago, you would see probably about 30% less number. It also shows how spread out those services are. So I think that those are some of the discussions that we have to have. And I think that we have to understand what that number is, because I think when we have a better understanding of sort of what that number is, it gives us a better understanding of what exactly we can accommodate. And clearly, I think that everyone can relate that parallel that as our marketability of our community declines, so does our tax base. And as our tax base declines, so does our ability to provide necessary funding for services to serve an increasing number of population that needs those services. And so to me, I just feel, and I've felt for some time, that there is an imbalance in that direction. Our ability to afford it and maintain a viable community declines as there is an incline in the service level delivery needs of an increasing segment of population. And I think that it's basic math, and I don't see the numbers working.
Well, one thing to note about this particular property in question that we're moving to, one of the comments that was discussed with the landlord before this particular population of individuals were going into the program was that, I guess there are two points. One is that the landlord was grateful for the opportunity to provide housing to individuals who were staying on average of 2 to 3 years. His typical tenancy there was anywhere from 6 months to 9 months. And so if anything, our particular population with our particular averages is actually increasing the housing stability of that particular corner. Additionally, Potomac Case Management Services also mentioned that for the individuals that were in those houses previously, certainly not all, but they made the joke of, well, I've been in just about all of these residences, what the apartments look like, because we provide case management services to a lot of the families that move through here. So in terms of the actual people that are going to be occupying that space, there isn't that much of a difference between the people who were there before and the people who are moving in. So the actual impact, if anything, is that we're increasing the tenancy and providing increased supervision and case management services in a much more focused way to that particular corner, which I think both the law enforcement individuals and the nearby property owners, including the child care center, appreciate the fact that there are gonna be more individuals coming in and out of that building that have the interests of both the individuals in the building, but also of the community around them, to make sure that these individuals, part of being stabilized in housing is being able to be a good neighbor. And so being able to create a structure for a program that allows them to increase that part of their rehabilitation, if you will, is part and parcel of this. And so in speaking of broader term, I think everyone here at the table has the same concerns that you do. I mean, I live in downtown Hagerstown. We bought hoping to see turn around within the communities. I live on Summit Avenue. I mean, this is my neighborhood that we're talking about. And so everyone here is interested in seeing both an increased capacity within Hagerstown and within these distressed communities to be able to provide stable housing, to be able to increase the tax base, and to be able to augment these services all the way around. And so, or augment the city's reputation and the city's livability. And so we are happy to come to the table at the Housing Summit to talk about how we can take these existing programs and have it be a part of a viable city plan. And coming back to this idea that this particular housing in this particular place is a temporary solution, and we'd love to talk to you about a more permanent solution that would work with the city's long-term vision of what you would like your individual neighborhoods to look like.
In this particular unit, you put new carpet in the entire building, painted the entire thing. There are new appliances. I mean, he's gone above and beyond to make his property as appealing as possible. So when we do leave this particular location, it will be attractive for other people to come in and rent.
And I think that, speaking of the temporary nature, that gets to my last point that I'd want to raise, and that is I've clearly had some question for city staff as this process has unfolded, probably the most pointed of which applies to the consistency of the application of our regulations. And again, my comments I don't think largely reflect you as a specific entity trying to do a specific task, but an example is I got an email that said that the doors won't be locking, and then I got another email that said, you know, the dining room doesn't meet square footage, and you know that we're going to waive that. And I got to tell you that my opposition to that negotiated process isn't in opposition to your specific effort, but rather how it is applied then to Mr. Burkett, who wants to do the same exact thing on an apartment right around the corner, and we give him a different answer than we would give you as an entity trying to accommodate a solution specific to you. And so if I have concern about that, it's a concern of the applicability of those codes and regulations being applied consistently among all property owners, not specific to whether it affords you the ability to move in or not move in. Because I think that for ourselves, you know, we were just here 6 months ago talking about regulations, whether no one wanted to say it or not, that had very real implications to, I think, Change Health Systems, you know, moving down the street. And that's a reality, and I don't want to head down that path, even with this specific instance, albeit I know it's to address an immediate situational need.
Yeah, we're looking for a longer-term solution. We felt pressure to take action, so we did, and we're certainly willing to work with the mayor and the city for a long-term solution with the housing, but it was in the best interest of our clients to make the move.
Let me just ask you two more questions. If someone were to enter the program today, how long would the program last for them? I mean, you're giving them counseling.
Right.
Presumably, to get them back on their feet.
Correct.
Yes.
Now, how long does that take?
It depends on the individual.
Okay, so they're judged as individuals, and not.
Yes, very much so. They're now with Potomac Case Management. They'll all have individual counselors that they'll meet with on a regular basis.
Okay. Now, once they get out, is there any follow up with those people, with those folks who have graduated from the program?
From the permanent supportive housing program aspect of it, no. But as clients of Potomac Case Management Services, yes, they would have follow-up services that would be available to them.
And how long will those client relationships last?
As long
as long as necessary.
So, and as long as that particular client fits in with Potomac Case Management Services parameters around their client service, and that not as a non-Potomac Case Management Services staff, I don't know the breadth of their programs, but I also know that they have a number of different case management programs that are available to suit both of the people that are going to be in this housing program as well as individuals in the community.
Okay, so
and for this particular program, it's 2 to 3 years on average.
On average, certainly we have people who stay longer. Certainly, right. There are people that stay.
So when they graduate from your program, it's not sink or swim.
No.
But again, the individual has got to want that caseworker. Mm-hmm.
Well, yes. Of course.
It's just like medication.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You can have the worst of the worst, and that person does not want to take that medication. Mm-hmm. It's not going
to
happen.
I know.
Can you speak briefly to the local issue? And that's the question I'm going to get from more people, or that's the question I will get most from
Oh, whether or not the individuals that are...
In other words, you know, we hear constantly they're coming out of the prison system down south and go straight into your program, you know, and... I've seen the numbers, and I don't see that that's the case, particularly as it relates to the prison system, but as it relates to individuals that come into the community.
There are no services that are provided in Hagerstown that aren't provided in Frederick or other communities. I mean, I've heard also that people are moving here because of the services that are offered, and that's just simply not true.
Right. So this is our permanent supportive housing program is one of 163 permanent supportive housing programs in the state of Maryland. So we're certainly not offering...
One of how many?
163. So we're certainly not offering a unique service here in Hagerstown that people are flocking towards.
Could I interrupt you on that point?
Sure.
Because this idea of ex-prisoners coming out is one of the issues, again, that
yes.
was addressed by Mr. Kumar in the Dagmar. And
yes.
because of new management practices there, they have significantly reduced. In fact, I think I heard him say, I hope he doesn't mind me mentioning this in public, but the parole and probation people are angry with him because they're no longer able to put the Dagmar on their list of places to transition out of prison. It's no longer an option as a housing plan.
For you.
So again, I want to give him credit for taking that action, which addresses that specific issue of prisoner population coming out.
I would like to say thank you, thank you to yourself, Mr. Mayor, and Chief, in the meeting earlier this year, which was, I believe, in January. We took your advice and we run with it. Mm-hmm. So in January, to December,
right.
I'm sure the new chief. So, well, you know, our statistics talk.
Mm-hmm.
And we've made it happen, and we continue to go the right way.
Thank you for that. And
you,
I'm not trying to mix this up, but it's very important right. for people to understand, because there's been a lot of publicity about the Dagmar specifically,
right.
but the Dagmar is more than just the Dagmar, and so it's good. It's important for people to know what's going on, and I appreciate, you know, and these are just updates that we got last week. So,
And so generally speaking to... To qualify for this program at all, you have to be a resident in Washington County for at least 30 days. Residency within the prison system does not count. If you don't have any income at all, you need to have residency within Washington County for 6 months or more. Generally, because of the wait list of the program, the average tenancy in Washington County for the people of this program, 60 to 75% of the individuals in this program have been in Washington County for 2 years or more. And so this isn't a program that people are, it's serving the majority of people.
We're not recruiting people from right. elsewhere.
Yeah. And
it's a good point.
They just seem to find Hagerstown.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
that's how it works. I mean, we're on the map. And believe me, by being on the map, we have it.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the amenities to go with it. All right.
Cumberland and Frederick are on the map too. I just want to point out.
I know that, but we're
lots of places on
we're the ones that's being hit the most.
This isn't a question, just a comment, and it speaks to my bringing up the housing summit, just to give you some flavor, because I think that there is a significant disconnect between sort of the operations of this body,
mm-hmm.
And the county, and the operations of the many nonprofits provide housing and sheltering and addictions-related services in the community. Is food for thought for any type of summit would be, you know, I hear from clients, you know, not from administrators, but clients themselves,
You know, why do I travel to 15 different agencies? Which one's the first one I go see? Who prioritizes me, you know, in the order list? Those types of things. So those are some of the questions or discussion topics that I think I would like to bring to that type of discussion with those agencies. Mm-hmm. Because even in the Homeless Coalition meetings, I get some feeling that there is a fairly individual sort of operations, you know, among, while you all meet there, mm-hmm. and everybody's sort of doing their thing.
Everybody has a silo.
It is, yes.
The idea is to break down the silos.
It's funny because mm-hmm. One of the projects in 2016 for the Homeless Coalition is to do strategic planning within the Homeless Coalition, because right. one of the things that's happening within a number of the homeless assistance grant sources, both at a federal level and a state level, they're actually requiring collaboration between the agencies that are receiving this funding. And so we will be working on a system that minimizes the having to go to 15 different agencies and where do I go. Mm-hmm. And so that will be our work within 2016, is to create a network to unduplicate services and to allow the agencies that do X really well to concentrate on X, and then create the appropriate referral mechanisms to get the clients who are screened for X to the X service.
And as I said at that meeting, I'd be more than happy to serve.
Well, we will be knocking on your door. So. And you're all individually invited to participate in that project as well. We really think that the city and the county government leadership will be great voices to have at those tables. So we'll let you know.
Have any questions or comments, feedback? I really appreciate your willingness to come here.
Well, certainly.
And your candor and your transparency, and
it's important for both bodies to be transparent to solve the problem.
Right, and certainly the Community Action Council is a big stakeholder in what we're trying to accomplish here, and I appreciate your willingness to continue participating in that process.
Thank you for inviting us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very close to on time on our agenda. It's now time for city administrator comments.
Nothing additional, Mr. Mayor.
Council comments. I'll start with Mr. Brubaker.
Nothing this evening, except I hope everyone had a good Thanksgiving.
Thank you. Mr. Alshire?
Three items. The first is, if I could get an update at some point on this piece of junk down here on Franklin Street.
Which one?
You know, the stucco thing that's
oh, the half burned down.
That's spray painted, half burned down, and the boards have now fallen off. Yeah. The second is just a reiteration of the comments from the public discussion at the Board of Ed. You know, about go see your city and county folks. I know I asked a few weeks back about possibly sending them a letter, reiterating our support for it, so that they don't have to tell folks that go to their meetings to come see us. We can just say, here's our letter.
Got our support.
Yeah. And the last item, I think I forgot. If I remember before the end, I'll bring it.
Certainly. Mr. Munson.
Department of Education.
I'm just going to raise one issue. Across from North Hagerstown High School, and Penny will appreciate this, I'm sure. Across from North Hagerstown High School, there is a strip of land where the grass between the curb and the sidewalk hasn't been cut for what looks like weeks or months.
Oh, they're making hay.
Now, I know there's an issue involving the Homeowners Association there, but unfortunately the job just isn't getting done because of that issue, whatever it may be. It's not going to take but a half an hour to cut those weeds, and it would look so much better if somebody could go out there and at least cut those weeds.
It's right on Pennsylvania Avenue across from North Hagerstown.
Yeah, we've cut it. So I've called the staff, and we've done it and put a lien, as I understand it.
Right.
Although,
yeah, we would.
They told me they were going to.
Yeah, because no one knows who
but
was.
These are behind the townhouses there?
No, it's right across from north. It's the strip. It's the Homeowners Association. Yeah.
Right, but the townhouses that back up to Pennsylvania.
Yeah,
the ones
that
back up. On the main road.
That's it. That's it.
They're off. You enter them off that first street. Sure. I've forgotten the name of it. It's parallel.
Yeah. I know where you're talking about.
Those weeds are about a foot high.
But, it's an ongoing thing, and it's like a whack-a-mole. Every time you deal with it, it's it. But the main thing is that we ought to have some recourse somehow on that. Just having it, you know, it's a defect in the homeowners association statutes, I guess.
We can take over the commons.
No, I think that what you need to do is get with staff and find out exactly what's going on, because it's not only with homeowners, it has to do with who had that development, what was supposed to take place. You need to get all of the particulars. And right now, I do not remember all of it. So get to Kathy Marsh.
Because that's been at least 10 years ago.
I know that Kathy's working on it.
But Kathy knows all of the particulars on it as to what the problem is.
But the problem is the weeds don't go away unless somebody does something about it.
But Don, the problem is
you need to get to the bottom of what's going on and see if we can do some arm twisting.
We have contractors that are behind the eight ball because they can't keep up.
We have a whole winter to work this problem out.
Right.
If we could just get these weeds down.
Don, you know how many summers
we've
been trying to work out?
We'll get it cut. That's the bottom line. We'll get it cut.
We've cut it before.
Take his goat out.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else? That's it?
That's it. That's enough.
Ms. Nye. Oh, did you remember?
I did.
Go ahead.
Go.
But only number three, no more.
This is it. We had a conversation tonight with the folks from CAC, and there was an article, I think, last week where I think the paper, and I think this is the first time that it's happened in my memory, asked the county sort of what they're going to do about, you know, this county issue. And I'm thinking to myself, no one ever really says that. Everybody thinks, you know, that this issue
problem
is like confined to the city boundaries.
Right.
And I'm thinking to myself, you know,
they have a housing authority too.
And Greg, you know, said, you know, it's something we got to look at. And I think in our homeless coalition meeting, at least the one I attended, there was some vagueness on whether or if anybody was going to sort of go do similar discussions with the county. And I think that as we get into this issue and attempt to address it, you know, to the degree we have, as head on as we have, the county has to be at the table. Folks in this community have to quit seeing it as a City of Hagerstown issue, because it is not. It is not a City of Hagerstown issue. It is a Washington County issue that happens to rest primarily within the City of Hagerstown, because here's where all the services are located. And anybody that doesn't see that just needs to take a map of the agencies that provide those services and see that, you know, the concentration is here almost by default, and the county has to be an equal partner, not just a commenter, but an equal partner and wanting to address the issue.
I totally agree. And any homeless summit, the county should be a full participant.
Absolutely. Ms. Nye.
They don't know they have homeless. Okay, in letting the school board know that there's support, I did that today. I went to the school board, and to be quite truthful with you, I really don't know what I did say and what I didn't say, but I said it, all right? So
we'll watch it on YouTube
tomorrow.
That was
the long and short of that as I'm, you know, going through. But I did let them know that the city has been there to support as far as the academic hub, and that we continue on, and that I would only hope that we could get all entities back to the table, and went through the steps of how this was, where it went to, and now where we're at. I also went to the county commissioners. Didn't realize that. And of course, we're not supposed to interact with citizens either, because I was a citizen, but I know we do, okay? And I'm waiting to hear back from Terry Baker, because I said, you know, I really don't look at the news. I really don't look at the newspaper. And can you just please tell me where we really are with this? And Terry looks at me and says, we can't talk to you, Penny. We're not supposed to interact.
What?
Yeah. Okay, so it was just so funny.
I think
it really
the chair
was
of the meeting has the prerogative to recognize anyone.
No, not me, because I guess they figured, oh, don't go there. You may open a can of worms that you just don't want to open. But anyway, I did say that.
What's
it's time.
The old, was it Mark Twain that says, sometimes it's best to remain silent and let them think you're a fool than rather to open your mouth and prove them right?
Well, all I can tell you is that I think that the school board and the county are the two that really need to get into the mix of it.
Well, and to be
and then understand, and without having any, and I did open your name up when I said, and Now, we're not discussing, you know, the mayor going through his, because he's, you know, and I didn't say passionate, but anyway, I kept you out of it to keep everything on an even keel. But I did say that, you know, it's time to do what we have to do now. Mm-hmm. Now, the only hitch in this giddy up is that, and I was told this by somebody on the outside, that, you know, the talks are continuing, and the only problem that they can actually see is that we could have the prospect of the academic hub, but then we could also look at the talk of a new stadium, and if that happens, it could ruin everything for the academic hub. And let's hope that that is not the case, because if it is, at that point, I guess I will do a lot of screaming, because that would be absolutely ridiculous when we are looking at what should be a whole private entity, and that should be that whole stadium scenario.
Well,
and
it's
buying
ridiculous
up the team
to make them exclusive.
Right.
That's ridiculous.
I mean, that's,
they're,
you
both
know,
regional facilities.
Well,
that serve
the problem
the whole
is that if one is going to take it away from what
well,
has already
that's
been
them making,
and we have
that's
gone
called
over
politics.
And again,
that's called politics.
It's called
well,
politics.
All I can tell you is that hopefully it will not come about. Because this thing with this stadium has now come forward once again. Mm-hmm. And here
it's
we gonna are.
It's going to be there. We have a stadium. You know? Earth to Hagerstown.
No,
we have a stadium.
Stadium, but
it's
now
not going
the whole
anywhere. We have a team.
Is that here we go. But I just wanted to let you know.
It's funny
again,
how these conversations start circulating around in the community, too.
Well, obviously,
instead
they
of
knew,
letting formal actions come about
know,
with formal
they
requests,
knew.
They want to put carts before horses.
Well, they knew. And all I can
and
say is.
And separate and
is,
exclude even having a conversation
I am
about
there
something
as
based on a potential something else coming along
see,
the line.
See, he's in a tangent again. And I don't get in a tangent anymore.
Well, here's the thing that frustrates me, Penny, is I was planning on going to that county commissioner's meeting, too, and I just couldn't make it in time for the citizen comments. But really what I wanted to express to these folks is that,
well, this
especially
was on the outside. I'm
especially
you what
this
was on
is the
outside.
Time of the
this
holidays
not,
and
know?
Giving thanks and reflecting on the year. And the thing is, I like to think I have good, positive working relationships with each and every member of the elected body at the county commission level and at the Board of Ed. That personally, individually, I have nothing against these people. But, you know, there is a time where they represent us too. And to be held to account for, you know, it's like the Janet Jackson song, "What Have You Done For Me Lately?" You know, I want an answer to that question. And, you know, at some point, and I said it in the last time, and, you know, I might not have said it eloquently, and I might have said it with too much passion or whatever, but the bottom line is if there is a real issue about how the Board of Ed spends their money, that's fine. That, I said that's a legitimate question that the County
exactly.
Board of Commissioners should be asking of the Board of Ed. But let's not keep that from keeping us from having that conversation about the academic hub. I completely agree that
and
we should continue that conversation
on
the merits of
that
particular project.
Okay.
Absolutely.
And there should not be anything else to come that way of stopping this. Right. And again, I have
but
no
throwing
idea.
Up red herrings of, well, if you start talking about a stadium, we can't talk about an academic hub.
No,
that's
and,
just
and that's,
pure
no, the,
politics.
The whole, no, and it was not one of the commissioners that said this to me, okay?
I'm just saying.
So, but what I'm saying is, all of this, again, just seems to go right around that loop, and mm-hmm. here we are. Mm-hmm. I went because of the academic hub. It was very important. It's something that should be, and we need to move forward with it.
I appreciate you
for
doing
those
that,
who
up.
Could not talk it through, they need to talk it through. And from what I'm being told, they are at least back at the table. The school board, they had no questions to ask me because I was the one that was sitting there doing whatever I did that I don't even remember what I did. All right, now also the delegation is another thing. The delegation meeting, from what I'm understanding, did you get a back? Okay, so then everybody else has got what it's now supposed to be as far
we
as
we got our time. I think
it's
1:30 to 2:15, if I recall correctly, on the 15th at Hager Hall.
At Hager Hall.
Tuesday the 15th.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now, Mayor, in all honesty, with the goings back and forth and where the meeting was to be and the meeting wasn't not to be and the whole bit, the only thing that I can say personally, I feel if there was a conflict of where it was to be held, then it would have been a conflict to be held here as well.
Nobody was proposing that it be held here.
That was always the norm where we had our meetings, was here at City Hall, okay?
Not in my...
They always came
to us.
But in
the 3 years almost that I've been in office, we've been doing it somewhere else.
But they have always, that we've had. So if there was a conflict, there would have been conflict there too.
Right.
And I can't honestly see where that would have been a conflict, but I'm just letting you know what I feel. All right, I need to know when the whole budget talk is supposed to start with us.
By the way, on your last point about the meeting, delegation meeting, we will have that on our agenda next week to discuss prior to going to that delegation meeting.
No, that's fine.
I just wanted to make sure.
I just needed to know the time frame to get it on the calendar. That was this back and forth with emails. And when is it that the budget's supposed to start?
Budget session is basically starts today as far as the department
heads. The department heads.
Department heads are entering their budgets this month.
Okay, and then it will be coming then to us when?
Well, there's the month of January where we are still working on that. We're tentatively scheduled for a budget retreat with council at the end of January.
Okay.
Be the first one with you.
All right. Also, this whole time clock thing, which I've heard more and more from employees and punching in, punching out, the one clock not being right that you're looking at, the time clock being, and if you're off 3 minutes, then that way you could get a verbal fight by somebody. But yet, I'm also getting that not everybody does punch in and not everybody punches out. I just would like to know the particulars of all of that, because it's as
well, if you're an exempt salary employee, you're not punching a clock.
Okay.
So
it's all of the salary employees that are not punching in, not punching out.
Right. If everyone's on the time clock, but not everyone has been transitioned to the time clock system yet. So we still have groups of employees.
It's still, because with what it has, the whole system has caused, it's like, okay, here we are.
Right. There are groups of employees that have not transitioned on the time clock system yet.
Right. All right. And also, at some point, I need to bring back some of these events that have taken place, because there certainly has been some abnormalities that should not have taken place, and that has to be a discussion in its own. I'm getting very upset in the fact of how many things, and they may be petty to some people, but it's not petty to me, how we're kind of falling off the grid with some of the events. Also, Dot McDonald, and that has to do with hearing aids, had called Dawn, and she's come here to the meetings before, and she had asked whether or not we were getting the loop system, I guess, and I was told that would be a cost of $50,000 to...
Yeah, I think staff is looking at alternatives.
We are looking at that.
And what I'm asking is, it's for hearing aids so that they can hear.
Like the theater, I guess.
My question is, because that basically would be kind of like a disabilities thing, is there not grants or anything out there that we could possibly also look at?
Well, we can use egg fees. It's just a matter of how much and what kind of work. Because we've already replaced the carpet, it would be hard to tear up carpet. It would be cost inefficient to tear up carpet, put in the loop. But they're looking at other systems that may not be as expensive that would meet the same need.
Okay, she needed an answer, and I said, look, I'll bring it up. I don't know anything about it.
I think staff are still exploring those options.
You know, I don't know anything about it other than when she was here, and I know that she could not hear, and then the person who had done it at the Maryland Theater was here as well. And when they had done all of that over there. So, also, the tree lighting is on Friday night.
That's right.
And hopefully...
we're going to have some good cake and cookies at the Hager House this year.
Kristen, don't even go there. Yeah. Yeah. And I will be entering off of key, so I will be early. Because I'm not going around the horn to get all my stuff in there. Okay? Since also now we've got a change in that whole routine.
Change is the only constant.
That's right. Well, you know what? Change is good for some things, but when things aren't broken, I don't know why, in the name of God, we seem we have to try to fix them.
Mr. Metzner.
Two things, Mayor, just on the hearing system. If you're looking for a cheaper alternative, certainly contact the district court system, who have a system in place that involves headphones.
Gotcha.
And I'm sure that it's much cheaper, maybe not as nice as the loop system, but for $50,000, that's that. And the only other thing is, thank you, Mr. Kumar. Thank you for coming. Thank you for staying around. I am the one who brought up all the negatives about the Dagmar.
Thank you.
My negatives, my comments are reflective, unfortunately, on what has occurred at your establishment in years past, and obviously you know that. To hear that we have no sex offenders, to hear that the Dagmar is not going to be an answer for parole and probation at the prisons,
correct,
and to hear what you're doing to try to turn this around is a very positive thing. To have you here tonight, this is not the most interesting place to sit for hours, just to be here, is a very positive thing. I don't recall in 21 years of being on the council ever even meeting the individuals who were the owners of the Dagmar.
Thank you.
Let alone having a conversation with them about where everybody wants to go. As a young child growing up, we had the medical secretarial school, and the Dagmar is where the students lived. And the Dagmar was a nice place and had a good reputation. And, you know, we have an apartment complex in Hagerstown out of Cortland that carried a horrible reputation. That has changed by changes out there with management. And I'm very hopeful that in years to come, when people speak of the Dagmar, they will speak of it in positive terms. And if my comments fed those thought processes of the past, I want to make sure my comments now erase them, and thank you for what you are attempting to do.
Thank you very much. I'd just like to say to the board that we are in the Dagmar. We believe in it. My family relocated here, and my partner and I, my wife, we are putting full effort. Obviously, my partner being an agent for the Secret Service out of DC helps a lot with the input of working with the crime statistics and stuff, and my background of construction. So all put together, you know, we want this to fit in with your new downtown dream, you know, so we're putting our hand out there to you guys, and you know, where we make a wrong, we would love for you to correct us, and we're here to do just that. And I think our last 18 months in the hot seat should speak some volume. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I just wanted to, again, being that it's the season of giving thanks, I failed to mention at our meeting last week how thankful I am for all of our city employees. We had several HR-related things, whether it's in terms of the budget and the good work of the finance department or human resources with the health care. We really are very fortunate to have all 460-some-odd employees that we have and the good work that they do. They're hardworking public servants.
They are.
And I just wanted to express my thanks for all the work that they do on behalf of all the citizens. And, of course, the City Park lighting is this Friday. There will be some changes in terms of logistics, the stage being on Key Street, closer to the Circle, but nonetheless, the Circle will be open, but Key Street between the Museum Drive and the Circle will be closed. The stage activities begin at 6:15. That's when hospice will do their remembrance and light the luminaries, I believe, around the lake. And then the official tree lighting ceremony will start at 7 p.m. And I also wanted to recognize the USMH Feast and Frolic Scholarship event is also happening on Friday night. I'm going to try to make it there.
I'll be attending that.
Great, thank you. I'm going to try to make it after the tree lighting and all the festivities at City Park. But I want to thank them for the work that they do for that scholarship fund, because so many people benefit from that. And it really does help those folks who are able to obtain those scholarships. And that's it for me. So thank you. We are adjourned.
And go Maryland.